My special guest is an exquisite lady, and oh, can she sing a Latin song. Please welcome the beautiful Anacani. Oh, I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you, Malou. You're so sweet, my goodness. That's why you're my sweet sister.
We are sisters. You know, the last time we got together, we talked about your career in America. But before you joined the show, and during and after the show, you've had a wonderful career in Latin America. Tell us a little about that.
Well, I've been very fortunate, Mary Lou. My career actually started when I was a child. My parents were going through a divorce, and we seven children were wondering how we were going to be able to help, because my mom and we had to do something to survive. And I was one of the youngest, and some of my older brothers and sisters were at the time in school still, so a couple of them actually had to drop off from school so that they could start working. And we all needed to do something, so my way of helping was to sing. And we went to visit one of our uncles in Mexico City. And I say we went to visit because at that time I was already living here. It's a long story, but I was born in Mexico, brought here when I was a year and a half. I actually went to school here. And during that difficult period when my parents were going through a divorce, we went to visit some relatives in Mexico. And he was on television, so he gave me kind of a lead to get into the station, and I was discovered by Mario de la Piedra, a great director at that time, for Televisa. And I started singing right away. I mean, the stars were on me, and they really, I just was very fortunate. I was discovered, and right away on television, I started recording, I started touring, and on one of those tours is how I happened to meet Mr. Welk.
Down in Escondido.
Right.
You've continued all through the years to do a lot of Spanish-speaking television
as
well.
Yes, that was so much fun. I mean, I was doing Lawrence Welk, and at the same time, I was also doing a lot of Latin American things, which gave me an opportunity to keep up with the contacts that that I still have to this day. And I did a couple of shows that helped me interview a lot of the Latin stars back then and a few that still are very big to date.
You have a wonderful family.
Oh, thank you, Mary Lou. I do have a good little family. I have to say, well, they're little because it's only my husband and my daughter, so it's not a huge family. But I don't know what I did right in life to deserve my husband, first of all. He's such a wonderful, wonderful gentleman, and very bright, and very respectful. A gentleman in all the sense of the word. And my little girl, I couldn't ask for more, my Priscilla. She is so dear, and I tell you, I must have done something right along the way in my life to deserve both of them.
She's studying to teach English.
Yes, she is. This is her second degree she wants to get. She went to Europe, as you know, when she was studying abroad, and she learned how to speak Italian very well. She now speaks English, Spanish, Italian, and she's working on French. And I am just so proud of her. She's turned out to be such a wonderful human being.
When did you learn to play the guitar?
Oh, my guitar. I'm back on that again, Mary Lou. My nails are good for that. I took it actually before I even knew that I was actually learning an instrument, because as you know, my grandfather, my mother's side, he was also a musical director like Mr. Welk, and he played all kinds of instruments and had his own orchestra. And I guess that was just a way of life for our family ever since we were children, we all played an instrument and we all got together and we were together a lot, and music was a big part of it. And so I guess I picked it up before I even knew, and maybe 6 years old.
And you're still playing.
And I left it for a while when I was doing the Lawrence Welk television tapings, and I just decided one day I have to learn to master that instrument, the guitar. So you'll see me playing good one of these days.
You play very well.
Thank you.
Your mom has always been a big part of your life. Is that still true?
Well, you know, my mom, she has always been such a great role model, not only for me, but for all of my brothers and sisters. She's a very strong person. If she weren't strong, she wouldn't have been able to raise all of us kids. For that, we admire her. She's got great values, a wonderful heart that everybody that meets her, she just gives her heart, you know. So she is a great role model. And she's now my little girl, in a sense, because I take good care of her.
I remember when Lawrence first met you, he asked you if you were a movie star. When we were taping the show, you actually had a chance to be in a movie.
Oh, you remember
that? What was that like for you?
Well, that movie was titled Zoot Suit, and I was approached by a wonderful director, Luis Valdez, at that time, when we were still doing Lawrence Welk. And I guess he saw me on television and thought that I would be good for this particular role. It was just fun, and I thought something like this to do once in a lifetime is good, but I don't think I could be in acting after that, because it was just a little difficult as far as not like the television shows, or when you do it in an hour and you move on. This actually took about a month, and it took me away from my family, which was not too good because I love family time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And even though now I travel, you know, quite a bit, but I go and come back. And
Short trips,
right.
Well, I think anything you would do, you would be successful.
Oh, thank you, Mary
And
Lou.
It's been so much fun having this time together.
Likewise, and let's do it again.
My special guest is an incredible performer. She's the funniest person I've ever known, and I'm so glad she's my pal. Please welcome Ava Barber.
Hi,
Hi Ava.
How are you, Mary?
I'm so glad you're here.
Well, it's good to be here.
What do you think when you look back at this show from 1976?
Well, I looked at it, and I was young and thin. But I was very shy, you know, and backward, and but, you know, that quickly disappeared because I made a lot of great friends, and Anacani, you know, she helped us find our first apartment, and then I started hanging around with the Otwell twins, you know, and we just had a great time. And then Joey Schmidt, you know, he's a terrific guy, and he lives in Nashville, Tennessee now, got two daughters, a lovely wife, and playing behind Alan Jackson, you know. So, you know, it's just a lot of memories, you know, that you can't do away with.
Well, when you joined the show, you'd only been on the show about 2 years when this aired.
That's right.
What were your first impressions?
Well, when I went out there, I didn't think I was going to be hired. He hired me right on the air, and I didn't know that was going to happen. So we just came out with a suitcase, me and Roger did. And the shows were taped a month ahead, and so I was taping in February, and so they weren't shown till March, and you all were getting ready to go on a tour. And so he took us down to Escondido, his resort, and we started working there, and we didn't have any money. So we had a car back in Tennessee, and we sold our car and got some money. And we'd never been out on our own, because when we first got married, you know, we lived with my mother, you know. So it was just strange to, you know, be out on your own and never had done that before, you know. So a lot of things, but a growing experience.
Did you watch the Lawrence Welk show?
I did every Saturday night with my mother. That was her favorite show. And we only had one TV. Kept up with everybody. And my daddy, he just saw how much she enjoyed that show. And he said, Ruby, one of these days I'm going to take you out there to California and you're going to watch them tape that show. And of course, my daddy passed away. He didn't get a chance to fulfill his promise, but he passed away in 69. And then in 74, I got with the show. And so she got to come to California, come to Lake Tahoe. And so her dream was fulfilled.
Oh, that's a great story. Now, the last time we got together, you spoke about your conversation with Andy Griffith.
Oh, yes.
And what that meant to you.
Oh, yes.
Well, I understand there's a new celebrity in the Ava Barber fan
club. I don't know
club.
What's happening. I have no idea. Well, I was in Escondido doing the Christmas show, and Roger, my husband, called, and we have a dear friend, Marshall Andy, in Tennessee, and he has a show on PBS. He shows all the old westerns and stuff, and he's a real good friend of Eddie Arnold. He goes down to Nashville and sees him every 2 weeks. And so he called Roger, and he said, you know, I was down seeing Eddie Arnold, and Eddie Arnold would like to meet Ava. Do you think she would like to meet him? And he said, absolutely. So
what a thrill.
In February, I went to Nashville and met Andy, and he reminded me of, I mean, not Andy, Eddie. I'm getting messed up, all the big stars. But Eddie reminded me a lot of Lawrence Welk. And we sat in his office and talked. We went out to eat with him, and he played me his songs, and he signed a picture to me. And I said, well, aren't you going to put I love you? And he said, well, I was just getting ready to ask you about that. But what a thrill, what a thrill.
And I also heard that you got a very special telephone call on your birthday this year.
I did. Roger, you know, he goes out with Charlie Pride a couple of times a year as the stage manager, and they go to Canada. And Roger, my husband, got Charlie Pride to call me on my cell phone, and I didn't know, and I didn't answer it. And I'm glad I didn't, because, you know, I've kept the message. But Charlie Pride called and wished me a happy birthday. He said, there's a little fella here, says it's your birthday here. So I want to call and wish you a happy birthday. And what a thrill that was. So I had a special day.
Well, you have the most supportive husband in the world.
He is. He is... He's one of a kind. Of course, we get on each other's nerves, you know. After 35 years, you drive each other crazy. But he's just always been supportive and pushed me. And you know, it's so funny. The early days of being on the Lawrence Welk Show, he learned how to be a stage manager through Jack Immel and Johnny Klein and Barney Liddell when we would go out and do the Lawrence Welk tours. And so here he is, you know, learning from the masters, you know, and he's a great guy. He's back at home keeping the home fires burning.
And Lawrence really appreciated him, too.
He did. And you know, when Lawrence saw what you did and said, well, hey, that's something, you know, he appreciated you. But I remember we'd go on tours, and we were on a small plane, and Roger had to do a diagram of each piece of luggage and equipment. And Lawrence was standing out there one day and saw him do that, and putting the luggage and equipment in certain places. And he says, that's pretty interesting. And so I think at that time he really appreciated Roger and what he added to the organization.
How are things going at Steamboat, your fabulous sandwich shop?
Well, we're growing. And, you know, it's so funny. I have always, you know, Brian takes us out on these live Lawrence Welk Show tours, and I'd always told Brian, you know, hey, we need a caterer if you ever come through Tennessee. So we played Pigeon Forge. And so we catered the sandwiches. Everybody loved them. And then the second day we had spaghetti and garlic bread and banana pudding. And, oh, it's making me hungry. But everybody seemed like they really loved it, you know. And it's growing. And the people, you know, it seems like we're having more people this year.
Gail and I almost killed each other over the last pimento cheese sandwich.
That's your favorite. But things are going great. Things are going great.
Well, right now you're part of a brand new show in Branson.
I know. I can't believe this. I'm real good friends with Mary Lou Turner. She lives in Branson, and she worked with Bill Anderson for a lot of years as his female singer. They had a lot of hit duets, and we were talking with them, and they were talking about bringing back the Grand Lady Show. They had it like 3 years ago. And so I just called Norma Jean, which used to be Porter Wagoner's female singer, on his show. And I said, you know, if you need a sub or somebody gets sick or needs time off, I'd love to do the show. Well, It winded up, I got like 16 weeks. And it's so much fun. There's seven ladies, and it's called The Grand Ladies Show, and it's at the God and Country Theater in Branson, Missouri. And we've got Jody Miller, Leona Williams, Norma Jean, myself, Mary Lou Turner, Wanda Jackson, and I'm missing one. I'm trying to think of all of them. But we have so much fun, and there's three of us that work, you know, each week, and we rotate, you know. But we're going to do it next year, too, from what I understand. So I'm just having a blast. I'm having so much fun, and you're going to get to come see the show. So I just love it.
I'm so excited.
Because I looked up to all these ladies and followed their careers, and I've come around from the Lawrence Welk Show to a country act. So it's I'm having a blast. I just love it.
Do you have some favorite Lawrence Welk stories or memories from your years on the show?
Well, I remember when we first joined and we went on a tour and we were in Pontiac, Michigan. And we had two shows. And so after the first show, we went back to the hotel and everybody was exhausted. So we ate and we went back to our rooms and Roger told me, he said, "Now, Ava, wake me up at 7 o'clock. That's when the bus is leaving, you know." And so I said, okay, and I fell asleep too. And so the bus went on without us, and we ran out the door, and there was a policeman there, and he took us to the venue. And I got there like 15 minutes before the show, and I said, good, I'm all right. And Lawrence, you know, I got word that Lawrence wanted to see us, you know. So we went back there to see him. He says, "I understand you missed a bus. Don't let this happen again." And so that made me be more aware of time and people's time and try to be on time. And it made me grow up. And then there was another time where we played Nashville. And it was so funny. Guy and Ralna did a surprise for me, and they rented a limousine. And it met us at the airport. And Guy and Ralna said, "There's your limousine." And Lawrence got in a station wagon, and I got in the limousine. So that's a memory I'll never forget. I had it the whole day, you know. We went and ate and just had a big old time.
Well, you've got a big old time coming up because your high school is going to honor you.
I know. I can't believe that either, because I was the worst student in the world. My favorite subjects was lunch and music. And lunch was first. And now they've got like a central high school, a wall of fame, and we're going to have a ceremony in September 22nd, and they say you're the youngest member on the wall of fame, you know. So I'm really happy about that too. You know, it just seems like as I've gotten older, things are opening up for me, and it's such a thrill, you know, because I can't believe it, you know.
Ava, anytime we can spend time with you, we know we're going to make some wonderful memories.
Oh, thank you, Mary Lou.
Thank you so much for being here.
Appreciate you having me.
Hey, Tiny.
How you doing, Mary Lou?
Great to have you back.
Thanks. It's great to be back here.
Now, you actually sang on this show.
Yes.
How did that come about?
Well, it's very interesting because I really didn't like to sing that much, but I was standing there one day. George Cates and Lawrence were standing there talking to Buddy Merrill, and they wanted him to do the cover record for Chuck Berry's School Day, which was a big hit. Buddy says, "I don't want to do it," and I'm standing right behind him listening. I says, "I'll do it." So I always figured it was my angel pushed me into that mess.
You volunteered.
I volunteered, and we did the record with Jimmy Haskell as the arranger and conductor. We had Plaz Johnson, the Pink Panther on the sax, and we had the Sportsman's Quartet in the background, and it turned out great. And Jimmy Haskell told me afterwards, he said, "You know, you would have got this out 2 weeks earlier, you would have given Chuck Berry a run for his money." So I was always happy I didn't do that, because singing was not my forte, but I always sang a lot.
Well, I've uncovered some facts about you that I would love to have you comment on. You won the Best Housekeeping Award in military school.
I did. That was seventh grade, believe it or not. I went to this first military school, and the younger kids were in seventh grade. We lived in what they call the cottage, and we had a sergeant there that was in charge of us, and so they had an inspection. They come down there, the captain and all of them came. Well, I pulled the mattress off my bed. I took a wash rag and washed around each spring. They had coil springs. I washed They couldn't find any dust. They couldn't find anything. They gave me the award for the whole school for the best housekeeper.
Now, you were in ninth grade with Marlon Brando.
That was the second military school I went to. That was Shattuck Military. It was Faribault, Minnesota. And I went there, and I knew that Marlon Brando was there. I didn't know who he was. But I found out afterwards Marlon Brando was there, and I became friends with Gordie Hormel, Hormel Meatpacking, and sure. He was a piano player. So he started a trio, and they had me playing bass.
Well, you hitchhiked from Minnesota to Texas.
Yeah. I left home when I was about 16. I got mad one day at my dad, and I took off, and he's yelling at me, and I just walked down the alley and out to the highway and started thumbing it. Then snow in York, Nebraska, and I hitchhiked all the way down to Ringgold, Texas, which got burned up last year. You know, there's nothing left of that town anymore.
Oh, my gosh. Now, you mentioned you played the bass. So how did you learn to play string bass? And you also played tuba as well.
Yeah, I played tuba in the high school band. And then I'm fooling around the band room one day, and there's a bass fiddle there. So I picked that up and started playing the first thing you know. One of my early bands was, they hired me to play bass fiddle and doubling tuba because they played old-time music.
So you were self-taught on those?
Yeah.
Now, did one of your teachers really lock the piano so you couldn't play?
Yes, that was, it was called Hart College at the time. It's now Midwestern University. And the band director really liked me. I played tuba in the band, and I was fooling around with the bass fiddle in the local symphony. And I was studying music, so I'd sit down at the piano and start playing some, you know, wild jazz type stuff. And this real old lady was the head of the music department. She didn't like what I was doing. She locked the piano up, so I went to the auditorium. I heard there was a grand piano in the auditorium. I started going over, sneaking over there and playing the piano. The next thing I knew, there was a canvas over the whole piano. It was padlocked around the bottom, so.
They just didn't appreciate
no.
you. I have a note here that says, singed eyebrows. Now, that sounds like it has to be a good story.
That was on Lawrence on the Welk Show. That was Bob Lito at the time was singing The Wreck of the Old 88. And the department that does all the fancy stuff, they built a piano, and they had hinges. They had hinges on it. So at the end of the number, I'd hit the piano, and the certain hammers would come flying out of the piano. The flash would go off, the flash powder, and the top of it would fly open at the end of the record. Well, I was too close to the piano, and the flash powder burnt, singed my eyebrows.
Now, after you left the Lawrence Welk Show,
yeah,
what did you do?
Well, I stayed around L.A. for about a year or so. I was learning to talk on a microphone because I never had that chance on the Lawrence Show unless he put me on a spot, you know. But I played in the early 60s. They had all the bowling alleys, had beautiful showrooms. And I played all these different showrooms. Then I finally got a group together. I went to 1961. I went to Tahoe, the Harrah's. And I played up there with my show band. And 63, I finally went to Vegas at the Riviera, my first Vegas job. And that's what started it all.
Now, when did Dinah Shore discover you?
Well, that was at Harrah's. That was at Tahoe. I was playing in the lounge. And she had heard about me, and she was in the big room, and she walked on the stage as I'm sitting up there and put her hand on my shoulder. She says, "I love your playing. You're going to be on my next show." And that was it. I went on her show, and
this was her television show.
Her television show, and I showed up, and she wasn't there at the first show. I got there early, and so the music director had me. He said, "Well, play something like Canadian Capers." So I'm playing, and she walked in and says, "What's he playing? I don't want him to play that. I want him to do those boogie things. I heard him at Tahoe." So she took control real fast, which I'm very happy she did.
Now, was that when you did your skit?
That was another, that was the
you
same
Mr.
show.
Mr. Big?
Yeah, she did a scene with George Chakiris from West Side Story. And Keeling Smith was her maid. And she walks in carrying this luggage, and she's trying to sing and get a big part in the movies. And I was Mr. Big from Hollywood, and I had a French beret on. That during rehearsal, I picked up a cigar, and I had a cigar in my mouth. I had lit it, and it was lit. And I sat down, and she either sat on my knee or she sat right in front of me. I don't remember exactly how it happened, but I accidentally blew the smoke in her face. And I apologized. I said, "Oh, no, that's great. Leave it in." She liked that.
You also were on Ed Sullivan.
I did a couple of Ed Sullivan shows. I did one with Connie Francis and the little puppet that used to be on Papatino, wasn't it?
Topo Gigio.
Yeah, that's it. And I did one with the McGuire sisters. They sang the Muscat Ramp while I played the piano. Then I did another one on Ed Sullivan where piano's a hard thing to sell. The only one I knew that sell it was, besides Joanne Castle, she knew how to sell the piano. And showmanship was, of course, Liberace. He knew how to sell it. So they decided to put about six or eight dancing girls around me. They're laying on top of my piano and kissing me on the cheek. Yeah, I had a lot of fun with that show.
Kind of like the Gold Diggers.
Yeah.
But you did work with Dean Martin.
Worked with Dean Martin. I did a show with Dean Martin with Lucille Ball. We rehearsed all week. And she was really a trooper, really great.
Clint Eastwood always thought a lot of you as well.
Yes, Clint. I didn't know that. He used to come, he lived at Tahoe, and he used to come and see me at the different casinos.
You've also been given a great honor for the 2008 Sacramento Jazz Festival.
Yes, they surprised me.
This What's your title?
Year, 25 years I've been doing that festival. I'm a very shy person. And they said, "You got to go to the convention center. They want to see you." I said, "Well, I didn't sleep much. I'm going home." "No, you got to go over there. You don't know what it's about." I said, "I have no idea." So I went over to the convention center. Here's all these great musicians that are Harold Hall, the guitar player, all these great. So they got me on the stage and put a sash around me. All the people were cheering. There was thousands of people there. They made me the emperor for the 2008 Jazz Festival.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
You are the emperor of the piano.
The emperor.
And you can come back and visit us anytime.
I'd love to.
Hi, Bobby.
Hi, Mary Lou.
So good to have you here.
Thank you, thank you.
Now, what do you remember about this show?
Well, the theme of the show was Big City, USA, and we were looking for a song to dance to, and Elaine came up with the idea of City Lights. She'd always wanted to dance to that song. And I thought, well, it goes back to Charlie Chaplin times, that song and that theme. And I thought, if we put Chaplin together with the song and put on the costumes, and then we could take them off and go into like a Bob Fosse type dance, a jazz dance, you know, would have something kind of unique.
I loved it. It was great. I understand you had a special concoction you would take before the show. What was it?
Well, you know, we did such a long day on Tuesday when we taped our shows. We did like three camera run-throughs and then a dress. And then right before the show, you needed a special little push, at least I did, you know, doing all the physical work that I was doing and all. So I was talking to a wrestling coach one time, and I said, "What do you do for your kids to get them up for the match?" And he said, "I give them an orange and some honey." So I tried that. So every time right before the show, between dress and show, I'd go over to the commissary and have a couple of spoonfuls of honey and an orange to give me a little extra push.
You still do it?
I still do it, yeah.
Fabulous. I understand you also have a famous Bobby Burgess two-day diet.
Well, actually, it's Berdine Florin, my mother-in-law's diet. But, you know, when I do my act with Elaine, I have to get into my little black jumpsuit again. So I have to diet a little strenuously. And so it's a two-day diet. You take off 5 pounds in 2 days. So you have two eggs and grapefruit for breakfast, steak and tomatoes for dinner, and then prune juice right before bed. 2 days later, you lose 5 pounds, and it works for me.
Every time.
Every time.
Was there ever anything on the show that you wanted to do but didn't get to do?
You know, I got to do everything on that show because we did our own choreography. You know, I did everything from polkas to waltzes, Latin. I got to tap dance with the guys. I just did everything. So I just enjoyed 21 years of choreographing my own routines along with the help of my dancing partners.
Okay, the other side of that coin. Was there anything you wish you had chosen not to do?
Well, I wish I hadn't broken my foot at the Hollywood Palladium doing the polka, but we turned it into a positive because I had Sissy put on a cast at the same time, and we did songs on the show like, All We Need Is a Break, and I Won't Dance, Don't Ask Me, and then we even did it in Tahoe, did shows up there with the cast on. Yeah, and then I was doing a double death drop with Elaine one time and pulled my rotator cuff on my shoulder. Oh. And I dislocated my tailbone doing the Charleston. So those are things that I wish hadn't happened to me when I was dancing.
Do you have any particular number that you're especially proud of?
You know, I think I have particular numbers with each partner. Barbara and I, my favorite number with Barbara and I, way back in the 60s, well, actually, when she came back, when I was looking for a new partner after Sissy left, she came, did 11 shows with me. We did Wedding of the Winds on the County Fair Show. It was a Viennese waltz, and I really liked the way that one came off. And then Sissy and I liked the Balboa that we did, you know, the fast bouncing dance. We did it to When the Saints Go Marching In.
I remember that.
Yeah, we opened our act with it when we went on the road. And then with Elaine, I think it was the first year we did a dance, a bolero to Ballet High. And we created a new lift where she went up on my shoulder with one knee and loved the music and the nice setting. And Lawrence Welk.
I can still
Welk,
see that one.
That was a favorite of mine. And then Lawrence Welk liked us to do the English quick step. That was his favorite for all my partners. And he liked the little step called the flicker, where you put your feet together and your feet flicker like this. You go, ha, 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 Bobby and Barbara, ha, ha. Yeah, he loved that. Yeah.
With Dancing with the Stars being so popular nowadays, partner dancing is cool again, ballroom dancing.
That's right.
Do you find that in your cotillion?
Well, I know that attendance at dancing schools went up 25% because of that
really?
Show. Yeah, but the kids love that show. They watch it and all. But yeah, I have 1,800 kids for cotillion ballroom dancing. All my kids teach for that for me with the cotillions. But yeah, they love to watch that, and they want to learn how to dance together again, you know, after so many years of doing the twist and all the strange dances that kids were doing. They're back wanting to learn ballroom dancing.
Myron Florin passed away before we ever had a chance to interview him. And as his son-in-law, you got to know him in a way, not as a performer, but as a person. What would you like us to know about him?
You know, Myron was real sentimental. I mean, he cried at the drop of a hat, not only at sad things, but at happy things, like at weddings and when my kids would do a recital, that type of thing. And he was quite a humanitarian. I mean, actually, it was an easy touch. There was always a stack of requests for him to fill charities. I mean, he always answered every charity with a check. There was never a time he said no. And, of course, he did the Myron Florin extravaganza so many years with the whole band and all the singers and dancers and raised thousands of dollars for Sentinel Valley Hospitals, their heart wing. And the Lutheran Church, he did all kinds of benefits for, like, building funds in Palos Verdes and Inglewood and all.
He even had a nickname.
I thought you might bring that up. The band on the side nicknamed him Mr. Benefits, but that was a compliment, and he laughed at that.
He was always available.
Mr. Benefits.
Well, you've practically made a second career out of traveling. What's the
Just
next
for fun.
Burgess adventure?
Well, last year, Christy and I went to China and Turkey, and this year we're taking the entire family on a safari to Africa and Zanzibar, so that should be fun. And then a little later, Christy and I are going to go to Berlin, Prague, and Krakow, so that should be an adventure.
Is there any place you haven't been that you still want to go?
We haven't been to the pyramids or the Holy Land. We'd like to see that. I'd love to see the Taj Mahal in India and Angkor Wat in Cambodia. And I think it would be fun to take one of those train trips across Canada with the entire family and stay in some of those great hotels that overlook the Rockies and all.
There's some beautiful scenery there.
Yeah, Canada's beautiful.
You also have four fabulous kids.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Talk about them. Tell us what they're doing.
Well, Becky, the oldest one, the one that used to dance the polka on the Christmas shows, she is working behind the scenes on television and movies. She's doing set dressing and wardrobe and model shoots, that type of thing. Robert's a guide at Universal Studios Hollywood, which he just loves, and he's going back to school to get his credential to teach history in high school. Wendy, she and her husband, Raymond Pagels, live in Las Vegas now, which gives me a great excuse to go to Las Vegas and see all those great shows. And she's a concierge at the Venetian Hotel, and her husband, Raymond Pagels, who's Dutch from Holland, you know, he is a beverage director at the MGM Grand. So they just bought their first house there, and so that's fun. And then Brent, my youngest, is still at home. He lifeguarded all summer at the YMCA, and he's at school now at Cal State Northridge, and he's studying film. So they're busy.
That's a full schedule.
That is for sure.
How about Christy, your wife?
Well, Christy got the brains from the Florence side. I'll tell you, she's so smart, and she went back and got her credential. She teaches at Sylvan Learning Center, mostly math. That's her specialty.
How long have you been married now?
Gosh, it's been 36 years. Yeah.
Wow. Where does the time go?
I know.
And is there anything you'd still like to do that you haven't accomplished?
You know, I'm a happy man. I have a great wife and kids, and my partner, Elaine Baldwin, and I, we're still performing together. It's been 28 years. We've never had an argument. Of course, we're not married to each other. But, we just did a show with the Lennon Sisters and Big Tiny Little down in Palm Springs in Escondido. So I'm still dancing with Elaine, and, we love to travel, and I'm just happy doing what I'm doing. Yeah.
What do you think was the secret of Lawrence's success?
You know, I think Lawrence loved his audience, and I think that's what he instilled in us. Know your audience. Go and give them what they want. I mean, we always put a waltz in our act, and we always polka. In fact, we even invite the audience to come up and dance the polka with us, because I think that's what they want to see, you know? But to entertain them, I think that's what he taught us. And you know, another little tidbit that he taught me? Always finish with the music. He said to me one time, when the music stops, I want you to stop your dance. You know, I said, you know, like a musical father would give you advice. And so that's true, because sometimes on Dancing with the Stars, the music ends and then they'll do a dip, you know, and I'm thinking, Lawrence wouldn't have gone for that.
Lawrence had a good eye for what was right.
Oh, yeah,
and
for
good
sure.
Instincts.
Yeah.
If you could choose one word or phrase to describe him, what would it be?
Wonderful, wonderful. I don't know. I think he just was such a great innovator, you know, and he hired people that really weren't slick professionals, and then they got better and better as they developed on the show. And he gave us complete rein. I mean, he let my dancing partners and I just create our own dance routines to that great music and do whatever we wanted to, which was really nice because, you know, we're not from a choreographer. We are actually expressing ourselves through our dancing to his music, which was really something special. You know, we're not doing a choreographer's thought.
It's
our own. Right.
Well, we hope you'll do it for years and years to come.
Well, thank you.
Because we love watching you.
Thank you. Love doing it.
I know you're going to love our special guest because she's larger than life as a personality and a talent. Lawrence Welk always called her the queen of the honky-tonk piano. Please welcome Joanne Castle.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes. It's so good to have you here.
I'll tell you what, I haven't seen that show in so many years, but a lot of memories came out.
Oh, you were the cutest bunny I've ever seen. Tell me how that came about.
I was the leader of the pack. Well, yes, they got me a bunny outfit. You know, they tried to do something different during each
that
couple.
That was different.
Yeah, very different. And then they'd give me an outfit or decorate the piano or something. And that was the first time and the only time that I wore a bunny outfit. And let me tell you, there was so much laughter because it was hard to walk in it, you know. And so I got to the piano at rehearsal, and there was a taping of the show, excuse me. Yes, it was showtime, and we were on, and it was very unusual for us to stop tape, as you remember that.
Oh, yes.
Yes, we went straight ahead. But this couldn't go on, because I fell right down on my tush. This big bunny outfit, and they had to get an audience went still. Everybody was real quiet, thinking I was hurt. Well, the only thing I heard is what, you know, everybody thinks. So
your pride.
My pride, exactly. So four or five guys had to get me up, get me to the piano, and I'll tell you, it was a very funny, funny scene. And I just, well, I gave them their money's worth, let me put it that way.
When you were a little girl, you told me your mom did a lot of scrapbooking for you,
yes,
about your career. Tell us about that.
Well, you know, before this show, I was trying to say, you know, give you some information that we've never told the audience before. And so I started with my very first scrapbook, which I'm 3 years old. Well, actually, my father and mother are holding me. That's how far back. But at 3 years old, I started singing and dancing in Bakersfield, California. And then my real name is Joanne Zering, Z-E-R-I-N-G. Well, I ran across all these little articles that went into the Bakersfield paper, and Joanne Zering will be the entertainment for the Kiwanis or the Lions Club. It was Joanne Zering. My mother, I don't know how she got it in the paper all the time. I don't know if she knew someone, the editor or what, but I didn't realize how much she was in my corner, like a manager. She always wanted to be in show business. She mentioned that. Yeah, she said, yeah, my dad, we couldn't afford it and all that. She wanted to learn the banjo or something like that, you know. But so I guess I was her girl, you know, in her place. And so she enjoyed it with me, traveled everywhere with me. Up until, even when I was 16, I started 17 traveling with Spike Jones.
Oh, my gosh.
I was with Arthur Godfrey, and we'd get in the old station wagon, and my mother would take this portable little sewing machine, a singer, and this little one, and she could fix everything. Along, she took photography lessons because we couldn't afford a photographer. She took my pictures. So a lot of these things, I'm looking in the scrapbook, and here's a picture of me, glamorous at 11. She had me posing all kinds of ways. One time on the floor with my hair in my hands. And so she was my photographer.
Oh.
So I have pictures, and I have my first dancing with a little outfit with a neighbor. And I couldn't get over all some of these things I laughed at because of this
wonderful
show.
Wonderful memories.
Because of this show, I got to go through it again.
So how did Joanne Zering become Joanne Castle?
Well, let's see. I think about 13, I was with Tex Williams, and I was on his radio show down at Knott's Berry Farm, California. And when we were calling people and talking to people, I'd say Joanne Zering, because my father and mother made me talk for myself. And like I was a grown-up woman, I'm only 13. So I'd say my name, Joanne Zering. What's that? Zero? How do you spell? It was always that. So they said, that's it. It was in the 50s. But anyway, so we're sitting around the dinette, and we went across some names. And my father was always thought that Corrine Castle, her name was, she bought all of Beverly Hills when the silent, she's a silent actress, bought all this property in California. And when Beverly Hills, she owned it all, and she sold it around 1930 or 35 or 40 and was a millionaire. So he wanted to call me Corrine. Well, I put my foot down right there at the table. I said, I will not change my name. I'm never going to be a Corrine. I'm Joanne. Now, you know, even at 13 or 14 years old, we were doing this. So they said, it's either Joanne Jensen or Joanne Castle. And the reason Castle, my father said, he was thinking ahead. He usually doesn't get into the show business part of my life. The Castle accordion somebody was playing it on a regular show in Los Angeles. And he thought, you know, if you're playing the accordion, the Castle people will call you and you'll be able to, you know, they'll want you
an
to.
An endorsement.
An endorsement. Well, they went out of business. they went out of business. And So we said Joanne Castle.
The name stuck.
Even at 14 years old.
Now, you met Myron Florin back in 1952, long before you were part of the musical family.
Yes. Shall I tell him my age or tell him I was 12.
Sure.
And Myron was 32. And he and the Lawrence Welk Band came to Ventura, California, where we had moved that time, from Bakersfield to Ventura. And there was the first time that the whole orchestra went out of town on a one-nighter. It went to Ventura, which is, 52 miles away?
The big city.
Didn't go too far. Anyway, they came to Ventura. And then they introduced Myron, saying he was going to be at the music store the next day, downtown Ventura, which is like 3 blocks long then. And so my father and mother said, you're going to see him. We're going. You know, they were firm about it. You're going, okay, okay. So we went to the music store, and Myron, I just adored him, and I said, can you come outside, and my mother can take a picture of you and I. So there's my mother again. She had her camera ready. So Myron and I went out in front of the street there, and in front of the music store, we're holding each other, and I'm just about this shorter than Myron then, at 12 years old. Anyway, so I told Myron about this years later, and you know, he said he remembered me. I said, you're kidding now, come on. And I showed him the picture years ago.
Because he made an impression even then.
Yeah, and he said, I swear to you, I remember you. So after a few times, I said, I think he maybe did.
I bet he did.
I hope he did. Anyway, we became good friends, and we did duets, you know, on the Lawrence Welk Show. And I never thought I'd get on the Lawrence Welk Show, tell you the truth, because I played accordion, there's Myron, and Big Tiny Little played the piano. So I just didn't think I'd ever get on until I was on as a guest, but I never thought I'd get the job, and I wanted the job, even at 19. You know, I was... I dreamt in the bed before I go to sleep. I could see Lawrence Welk saying, Joanne Castle. I could see it. It was 16 years old, 17, 18. I saw it in my picture in my head.
You had a dream.
And yeah, it was amazing, and that was my goal.
So what was your favorite number that you did on the show? Do you have one?
Yes, I do, because I played it so many times. Lawrence Welk was he just said, will you do that number next week? And I just got tired of it for a while. The Sheik of Araby.
Oh!
And he went on the road, and guess
what?
The Sheik of Araby. And he had me doing it on the road, too. The Sheik of Araby. And he'd come back and start playing with my ponytail.
Ah, we just did that.
So
on
one night we fooled him. The Lennons and I got together and we fixed it so when he pulled it and played with it on stage, it would fall out in his hands. And it worked. Nobody knew I was going to do this. And so we practiced in the dressing room. How much do I have to go forward for it to end up in his hands? It was very loose with just a little pin, you know. So here he's up there playing with the ponytail and I'm playing. At the very end of the song, Chopsticks, which it speeds up, I speed up on the time, I go forward. And it wasn't working. So I went real forward, and boom, it's in his hands. I was laughing so hard I couldn't stand it. Instead of taking a bow, I ran off the stage, and Lawrence had nothing to say. He was holding this long point in his hair, and people were laughing and applauding, and it seemed like it lasted 10 minutes. I mean, he'd go, he didn't know what to do. He didn't know what to do. I don't know what he said, because I ran. I ran back. I was back in my dressing room. I got back to my dressing room, and guess after when the show was over, a knock at the door. Hello, this is Lawrence. Oh, my God, I thought it was the end. I thought you can't do something without, you know, you couldn't
approval.
Do anything without proof with Lawrence Welk. He said, can we do that every night? Oh, no. And we're going to do it on TV when we get off the road.
Oh.
Oh, so on television, I had to do it.
And it's been immortalized on television.
And yes, I did it. And then when I left the show after 10 years, you know, I did for a while anyway, they had a dance couple, not Bobby and his partner.
Denise Curick.
Yeah, there were two amateur dancers, but they came down. He did the same thing to her, had her...
Her
ponytail come off, and they kept doing it. But I was the first one to give him the idea, and I should never have done it.
Well, you have two wonderful children, and now you're a grandmother.
How's
your family?
Oh, they're fantastic. My son has a little granddaughter. She'll be 3 in July. And a little Billy, and my son's name, of course, is Bill. And he'll be 2. Yes, he'll be 2 in December.
Wow.
31st. Yes, he was born New Year's Eve. I will never forget that. And they're stopping because the boy and a girl, it's all they want because they're working parents. Both of them work. So it's a little hard. So now she's cut down on her work so she could be home a little more with her little kids. Yes, their names are Lauren and Billy.
And your daughter, Joni.
And Joni, yes. She's
very successful attorney.
Yeah, she's an attorney. She's also moved up to San Jose now.
Oh,
she's an attorney.
So they're close to each other.
Yes, they're across the street.
Oh, that's
my
wonderful.
Son works there. He's a banking consultant, and my daughter's an attorney. The buildings are across the street in San Jose.
You also have a very special person in your life.
Yes, a very special person. 20 years.
Ah.
20 years, and they said it wouldn't last. Yes, yes. And you know what? You see this trumpet here?
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly what he plays. Lynn Viviano writes my arrangements, conducts for me on the road. He was many times. He was with Buddy Rich for many years, and Count Basie, and Woody Herman, and I could go on and on, but people who are in the jazz field will know what I'm talking about, because everyone knows Lynn Viviano, and I'm so We just like click like this. We do, and everything. Our tempers are the same. Everything's just like that. And I never thought I was going to ever find someone in my life. And he never been married or have children, so there was no baggage, just to say. That's not the right thing to say, but you have to think about those things.
You look like you make beautiful music together.
We do. We have for 20 years, and we're still doing it. I've got some concerts to do and shows, and I want to let everybody know I'm out there still doing it. And if you want me in your city, just ring.
We'll be there. Thank you so much, Joanne, for being with us.
Oh, that's a pleasure. I've had a good time. Thanks.
Hey there, Dick.
Hi there. How are you doing?
I'm good. It's so good to have you here.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
Okay, now tell me the truth. Did you ever spend time down on the farm when you were growing up in Iowa?
Well, not really, but we lived on a little acreage outside of town. It had 17 acres, a couple of cows, a couple of pigs, a lot of chickens, and a big garden. And it was...
Did you grow corn?
No, we didn't. Oh, sweet corn, yeah, not real corn. And it's all changed back here now. It's when I was a kid, if you farmed 640 acres, it was a big deal. Now they're farming 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 acres.
But you just moved back to Iowa. What made you move home to your hometown?
Well, I always say it's my sister-in-law, but that isn't really the truth. I had a lot of allergies, and when you go to the hospital 3 or 4 times, you start thinking about it. And the people were in Sparks were just beautiful, and the weather was great and everything like that, but I just had all kinds of allergies, and I moved.
It's better, huh?
Yeah.
On the show, you always sang and played in the band. Which came first, and did you enjoy one more than the other?
Well, when I went out on the road, I got out of school when I was 16 and went on the road at 16. And maybe I was too young, maybe my voice was still changing, I don't know, but I didn't sing at that time.
16. And,
but I went into the service. I was stationed down in New Orleans for a while, and a bunch of us used to go down to Pat O'Brien's in the French Quarter. And they had twin pianos, and this gal would play these songs and get people up to sing. So this is a song you won't even remember. It was like a chicory chick, chala chala, chickalaroni, you know, crazy song. And I'd get up and sing it. So when I got out of the service, I went back to Fairmont, Minnesota, and joined another band. It was just starting. And it was a great band. And so I said, hey, is it all right if I sing one? I said, sure. So they made an arrangement. Mamselle, a small cafe, Mamselle, you know. And that was my start of my singing career, I guess. I don't think there's an answer to which is the better one, because I love to sing, but playing, I got to play with some of the greatest musicians in the world, you know. And it was a big charge for me either way to do it, you know. It was
fun. How did Lawrence discover you sang?
Well, I was working in Minnesota, and we had the night off, and he was playing at the ballroom. So we went to the ballroom, and the trumpet man I worked with, he went up to Lawrence and says, hey, you got a guy out here who can sing. You ought to hear him. I don't think Lawrence was too excited about it, because the last song before the theme song, that's when I sang. But I told Ori in the band, the sax player, I said, well, if there's ever an opening, let me know. And from that time, I changed bands. I went to New Ulm, Minnesota, which was Six Fat Dutchman Polka Band.
Harold Loffelmacher.
And we did a broadcast every Sunday. I got through with the broadcast, and I was walking out of the studio, and the guy said, hey, Dick, you got a call here. And I went, hello? And he said, hello, this is Lawrence Welk. And he said he wanted to hire me. I said, well, I'd rather try out first. I don't want to come in and goof it all up. So I went to Chicago and tried it, and he said, well, he wanted to hire me, and we said, we're going to go out to the coast, out to L.A., and do a TV show. TV, I didn't know from anything, you know. But we went out to California, out to Aragon Ballroom in Ocean Park, right next to Santa Monica. And we did our TV show, live TV show, every was it Friday or Saturday. Anyway, it was, live. A lot of goofs, but everybody seemed to love it. And we played there for 4 weeks. Then we went back out on the road for the summer, came back in the fall, and started doing our TV show again. And it was great. We had Klaus Landsberg, who was KTLA producer and director, he did our show. He never saw the rehearsal. He just come driving up, grab the script, go out in the truck, shoot the show, you know? And of course, when we went coast to coast, we had a great crew, wonderful crew. And Ed Sobel, he was the producer for, Abbott and Costello. And then Jim Hobson was the director for the Liberace show. So we had people in the booth. And then when Ed died, Jim became producer and director. And it got to be a pretty heavy burden, so they took Jack Imel on. And Jack was a great idea,
fabulous.
Man. Wonderful man. Well, you danced with him all the time.
Absolutely. They don't come any better.
Yeah.
Were you there when you got new Dodges each year?
Oh, yeah. Oh, wonderful. Yeah. In fact, a lot of people don't remember. We did two shows. We did a Dodge show, and we did a Plymouth show. And I guess the Dodge people had a meeting, and the comptroller says, we can't give these guys cars anymore. I said, why not? It's just fouling everything up. And somebody stood up and said, well, I can guarantee you one thing. You take the Dodges away from them this morning, they'd be driving Plymouth this afternoon. So give them the car.
Were you around when Lawrence started buying buildings in Santa Monica?
I think the first one he bought was, he came down to the ballroom that night and he says, boys, he says, I just bought a gas station. I said, where? He said, at the foot of Wilshire Boulevard. That was the end of Wilshire Boulevard, and the next thing was the ocean, you know. And that gas station turned into an apartment house, a very big apartment house, and two big office buildings. And then he went on from there, and he went up Wilshire a little bit, and was building a Union Bank building. And when they got all through, he was going to pay cash for it. And his lawyer said, you can't do that. He said, why not? I got the money. But he didn't. They talked him out of it. But he's quite a man for real estate, really.
One of the things I used to love that you did that showed off your great sense of humor was Crazy Guggenheim. How did you do that? Do you still do it?
Yeah. Sometimes I do. You know, we were doing some production number, and we all were in period costumes, and I had a derby. And, you know, Frank Fontaine always pulled his hat down and over his ears. And so I was just kidding around. I did it, and they left it in. And so we did it up at Tahoe, too. That was a wonderful job. We had worked up at Tahoe for Lake Tahoe at Bill Harris Casino for 19 years.
3 weeks every year.
3 weeks, two shows a day. You call that a vacation? It was, because we did everything. We played golf, boated, sailed, everything. It was just wonderful, and they treated us great. But the Crazy Guggenheim thing was... that was on the show up at Tahoe, too, because I was doing Crazy Guggenheim, and I was doing Dean Martin. And Lawrence was back changing clothes for his little bit coming up, so he never saw what I did, which is probably good, because I ad-libbed a little bit. But Bill Hare liked it, and he told me so I mean, I was all right. But Guggenheim was I met him in Phoenix one time, and he was a wonderful man.
You have a wonderful family. We've watched your kids grow up on the Christmas shows over the years. Tell us about them. Give us an update.
Well, Rick and Lisa live in Dayton, and they have Ryan and Rachel, their children. And then Dee Dee has just moved to Montana with Tony, her husband. And Dan is living in Scottsdale, and David is working in the film industry, but he works out of Phoenix. And David has two children, Ava and Sasha. I'm too old for this. But they're all, you know, kids are all beautiful, of course, very smart.
And you have a wonderful wife.
Yeah, Margarita. She's just a...
How many years have you been married?
It'll be 57 years, I think.
She'll tell you if
yeah,
you're
wrong. I'm sure she'll remind me somewhere along the way.
What are you doing these days? What are you doing now?
Well, I've not been working much. We moved into a house in Algona, Iowa, and we had to remodel.
I bet you're a celebrity back home.
Oh, heavens, yes. I would say all the people in Iowa must watch the show, because I go downtown. I can't do anything wrong, because I'm going to hear about it. Everybody, I mean, even the box boy at the grocery store says, hi, Dick, you know, And it's wonderful. And we did a thing at Fort Dodge, Iowa. It was for a Dodge dealer. And, well, actually, this band had a free dance, you know, dance and stay healthy. Well, they expected about 200 people, and about 800 showed up. It was just wild. I mean,
fabulous.
It's great. You know, it's nice to be a celebrity.
Well, you'll always be a celebrity with us.
Thank you.
I'm so glad you were here. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
For sharing your life with us.
Thank you.
My guest is a very special gentleman. He's a singer, a songwriter, a comedian, a published author, a hypnotist, a husband, father, grandfather, and my dear friend. Please welcome Ken Delo. Hi, Ken.
How you doing, Mary Lou? I never knew I was all those things.
You are, and so much more. What do you think when you look back at this show? You can't go wrong with the music of Irving Berlin.
Oh, no. The music of, I think there's one part where Guy mentions Irving Berlin. He wrote over 1,000 songs and lived, well, over 100 years old, too. Just amazing. Amazing. A few songs I never really realized. The song that you do on the show with Sandy Gale and Mary Lou, the I Love a Piano, I didn't realize that he wrote that.
He did.
A long time ago.
Oh, yeah. And you actually remember seeing him once.
No, I saw him, it was on TV, but I didn't realize that when he did the song that I do on this show, Oh, How I Hate to Get Up in the Morning, I think it was he did it on Broadway back in 1919 or something. I didn't see him back in 1919, no. But he actually did that song on an army cot and the whole bit. So he was performer, too, which I didn't know until that time.
The last time you were here, we spoke about the show you had in Australia, the Delo and Daly show, that was on every Tuesday night. But at the time, I don't think I really appreciated what a big deal it was. There was a review that said, in one segment, Ken Delo just sat on a stool and sang. The Frank Sinatra special that followed could have been greatly helped by that segment from Delo and Daly. How does that make you feel?
It made me feel fantastic because, you know, as you say, we had our own show every week, and the Sinatra show was on immediately following us, had Louis Armstrong as a guest, and we had a clipping service that would send us different things out of the paper. And when I saw that, I thought, my Lord, this ain't... put something of mine in the Frank Sinatra special and would help it. So it was a big ego building thing. But we had wonderful times, though, doing our show. So.
Have you seen any of those old shows? Do they hold
up?
Yeah,
well, because, you know, which I think we get into later, I recently, in the last 2 years, moved to the Phoenix area in Arizona. And with all that moving, going through all my things, I came up with these boxes of film, 16-millimeter film, of a lot of the stuff off our show. And so I found a company, and I had them put on DVDs, and I've been looking at these shows, and I'm putting some stuff together. And it's astounding to look at these things. First of all, I say that's not me. I was never that young. And they held up very well. We were lucky because we had... We were the most expensive show ever done in Australia, for one thing. And it was a weekly, and we did whatever we want. We were executive producers. So it's something to watch something that you put together. You were the producer and writers and everything, and especially all these years later.
And it was on the order of a Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis.
Yeah, well, kind of. The comedy team with Delo and Daly was, on the order of Martin and Lewis. And I look at them today, and I keep thinking, because at that time, a lot of our people would say, I don't think you guys know how good you are. And I'm looking back all these years later, and it's terrible to say, maybe. I said, well, we were better than I thought. It's kind of an unusual situation that we became the biggest things in Australia. Then you come back here, and you start all over again. But
you told me you met a lot of stars back in those days.
Yeah, Australia... from 56 to 66, that was our first decade of having television. So they were bringing all kinds of acts over from America and from Europe and things like that. And so I got to, my partner and I were working our second month in Australia. The station sent us to Sydney to the big nightclub there called the Checkers. And we were doing the Easter show there with the dancing girls behind us and all that stuff. And one night the owner came, Dennis Wong, and said, Mr. Charlton Heston's coming in to see your show tonight. He was in town promoting Ben-Hur.
Oh, my gosh.
And sure enough, he came into the show. He was all alone. No one was with him. He sat for the whole show. And the owner had said, "Would you please introduce Mr. Hester?" We said, "Well, of course he will." So halfway through, he said, "Ladies and gentlemen, we have a wonderful man you all know here. He's here promoting his latest movie. Please give a wonderful round of applause for Mr. Charles Laughton." And sure, he started getting up. Then he fell on the floor. And we got to meet him and spend the next couple of hours after the show with Charlton Heston. But the owner of the club came and said, "That wasn't Charlton Laughton." He said, "That's Charlton Heston." We said, "We're a comedy team. That's what we do." But so I met him. I met Sophie Tucker, was over that same in her final years.
Speaking of wonderful people, you're married to a wonderful person, Marilyn. Oh,
yes.
How did you two get together?
Well, we're both from Detroit originally. She was 16 when I first met her, still in high school. I had a group we formed called the Hi-Hat Review, and we did shows at the different veterans hospitals and things. And I said, "Well, we need a girl in the show." And this one guy said, "I know a girl that's at this high school my sister goes to. She's a dancer. She was ballet." So they had her come to the show and at the Dearborn Veterans Hospital, and she started doing shows with us, and we did other USO things. So I've known her for a long time, and I'll tell you, I'm the luckiest guy in the world. She's a beautiful lady and the nicest person I have ever met in my life. And we have two wonderful children, which have been on the Christmas show every year. And we moved recently to Phoenix, Arizona, to be with our daughter. Kimberly is there. But Marilyn, as I said, she was a ballet dancer and model. She did a lot of modeling. She always talks about being on a yacht out in the Detroit River in January in a bathing suit in Detroit. But that's when they shot the things.
You're also a hypnotist. How did that happen?
Well, as a kid, I was always interested in doing magic. And I used to go down to this magic store downtown Detroit and buy my tricks, and they would teach you things. And in all magic stores, you're going to find ventriloquist books, and you're going to find hypnotist books and that. So I started getting interested in looking at the books and things, and I started doing it as a kid even. And then I really got interested not that many years ago as an adult. And I did some seminars for weight loss and stop smoking and things like that. And just at parties, I had fun too. And it's an amazing, I have a tape out, in fact, for stress and stuff like that. They can go on my website, candilo.com. But it's just a fascinating thing to me. And anyways, so.
We spent a lot of years together on the Welk Show. Do you have any favorite stories?
I don't know, there's so many things that happened over the years. There were things at times when, for a number of years, people used the fans, who are the greatest fans in the world, as you know, Mary.
They are.
Sometimes they would mix up the three of us. Guy Hovis, Clay Hart, and myself. They weren't sure who was who. And we were in Texas once doing a show with Lawrence on tour. And after that, the whole band was invited to some house. And we were there, and these three ladies were sitting on the couch, and they said, "We just love the way you and your wife sing." I said, "No, that's." I said, "Wait a minute." So my chance. So I went to the other room, and I brought Clay and Guy and myself. We stood in front of these ladies and said, "Now, this is Guy Hovis sings with Ralna, his wife. And this is Clay Hart. He's our country singer. I'm Ken Delo." And that's that. You can tell us, "Oh, yes." 10 minutes later, they came up to me and said, we just love you and your wife." So,
is there anything that you would still like to accomplish in your life?
I'd probably always be performing, and I've always mentioned I would like to do some getting into motion picture thing, but maybe the years have gone too much. I don't know now, into that part of it a little bit, and my going through all my old Delo and Daily tapes now, and I'm compiling some things, the editing and stuff on that, brings up other things that I'd like to do some more television, maybe a little things, and get involved in. I'm just a ham. I love to perform.
Thanks for being here, Ken.
Well, thank you for having me. Thank you so much.
Hello, Arthur.
Hello, Mary.
So good to have you here. What does looking back at this show remind you of?
Oh, many, many things. You know, I must say that one of the things that's most outstanding in my mind is the fact that the show has lasted so long and picked up so many new viewers along the way. It's incredible.
Now, on this show, you were saluting Bill Robinson. What was his impact on tap dancing?
Oh, I think he had a tremendous impact on tap dancing. He, you know, he goes back so many years and did so many wonderful things in show business. In fact, you know, there is a National Tap Dance Day on the 25th of May, which honors Bill Robinson.
Really?
And I just happened to finish doing a show. I was up in San Francisco. I was invited up to participate in a show honoring him, as well as Tap Dance Day, along with some wonderful people, Rosie Radiator and the Guinness World Champion Red Tap Team. And we had just a wonderful time up there.
What do you think of the young dancers today?
Oh, they're tremendous, tremendous. They've taken tap to a new level, and they've introduced a lot of new styles into tap dancing, which are just tremendous. I only wish I could do them.
I think you hold your own with anybody, Arthur. Who are your idols?
Oh, gosh. Mary, I think I enjoyed just about every dancer that appeared on motion pictures, and I got a lot of my learning education from that. You know, Bill Robinson, and I had Fred Astaire, Gene Kelly, the Nicholas Brothers.
Oh, goodness. Gosh,
there were so many that I just absorbed all I could from the motion pictures. In fact, I used to go when you could get in for a quarter, you know, and see the movies, and they would run almost continuously throughout the day, and I'd go as early as I could, and they'd have to send the sheriff to find out what had happened to me.
Now, is it true that when you were a little boy, you actually considered becoming a pharmacist?
Yes, well, as I, you know, thank God it didn't happen. But
where did that come from?
Well, I worked for an independent druggist at the time and made deliveries and helped out in the pharmacy and whatnot. You know, with people finding different things in the drugstores and.
And you enjoyed it?
Yeah, and I enjoyed it. And the pharmacist thought I would be a good candidate in that department, and I'm so happy that I didn't do it, because I stumbled into show business when I was 13 in the seventh grade, and I've enjoyed every step of the way.
Well, you were one of 13 children as well.
Right.
So that was a big family.
I'm looking for another 13 there. You know, the thing's running. So maybe that's a good day for me, 13.
Now, you're one of my only friends who can honestly say they're an international star. You've performed all over the world. I have some points here I want to ask you about. You were on television in Ireland.
Yeah. Go, Ireland. I did it in Blackpool. I did Eurovision in Blackpool.
How did that come about?
Oh, gosh. Well, it was all of these things evolved after I went to Australia on a 10-day tour with Jimmy Rogers and ended up staying for a year and a month. And I had met people along the way, Lou and Leslie Grade. I met two were big investors in the
wonderful
television station in Australia. And they had, at that time, they had big shows going in London. And he said, if you ever get an opportunity to come to England, we'd like to use you on our show. Well, I had my ticket round trip from L.A. to Australia, and it was a little to change it, and I decided, well, I'll never have this opportunity again, so I decided I would go around the world. Well, after making contact in Australia with all these various people, I had introductions on different places, so I went to Hong Kong and the back way to Europe, and got to Europe and decided, went to see some friends I had known, and they had a restaurant. They put me to work, and one thing led to another. It was a tremendous ride.
So you were at the Nile Hilton in Cairo.
Yes, I was booked down there at a big international agricultural convention, and gosh, I worked in Beirut, Lebanon at the Casino du Liban, and that was a fantastic gambling casino, and it was just incredible.
What about Switzerland?
Oh, yeah. Well, that's where I ended up. That's where I met the friends that put me to work in their restaurant called the Kenley. And it was a trio schmied, and they sang like the Moderneers, that type of thing. And, I used Switzerland as my base. I lived there, and I worked all over Europe and whatnot.
I also understand that you did some USO tours with Bob Hope.
They were mainly, you know, the Christmas tours, and then I did a couple of tours with him here in the States.
I bet you feel appreciated doing something like
that. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's very, very heartwarming, you know. And of course, Bob did it. Bob Hope did it for years, many, 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 many years.
Where did you go with him?
Oh, gosh, I went to Japan. I went to Korea, the South Pacific, went to Alaska with him, and numerous times down to Arizona, where he was very involved in raising money for the Boys Club.
You've met some fabulous people.
Yes, I have.
I remember you telling me you had a great experience when you worked on Diagnosis of a Murder.
Yes.
Which was with Dick Van Dyke, but it was before it became a
series.
Yes,
well, I knew Danny Daniels and other people that I'd met along the way, which you, as well as many, many people in the dance world, you know, meet these people. He was instrumental and in getting me on that show, because he did the choreography, and since then many things have happened as a result of that.
You actually got to dance with Dick Van Dyke, though.
Yes, and I got to tell you, Dick Van Dyke learned the routine, Danny Daniels, and put it together and helped him work out this little routine. And Dick at the time was having tremendous back trouble. He had, when he met Chitty Chitty Bang Bang in England,
sure,
he got sick or had an accident, and they x-rayed his body, and the doctor told him, he says, in 3 years you'll be in a wheelchair. Well, Dick didn't sit still for that. He says, I'll have none of this. So he learned the routine after that in traction, as well as on his back and whatnot. Danny Daniels and I did the routine, and Danny's wife filmed it from the back. And we only had maybe 2 one-hour sessions, and he did the dance perfectly.
Oh, what a great experience.
Yes.
And
nice man.
Extremely every once
nice
in a while
man.
I catch you on Columbo.
Oh, yeah, well, that was enjoyable. Well, you know, Peter Falk was just great to work with. I've worked with some real wonderful people.
Do you have any particular favorites?
Oh, gosh, I think just about everybody I work with. You know, you get kind of involved, and you discover that there are a lot of wonderful people in
you
the business.
You worked with Sammy Davis Jr., didn't you?
Yes, yes, in the film Tap with Gregory Hines and whatnot, so.
What a talented, talented man.
Yes, yes. He brought a lot to the table when they did that film.
What are you doing these days?
At this moment, I've had calls that people wanted me to go to Brazil and do a few master classes and perform, and I've had calls from Germany. So tap dancing is worldwide. It's even in Japan. I had a young lady that came from Japan, and I studied with her for about, she studied with me about for 2 months, went back to Japan, and she was a performer. And she learned very quickly, and she did very well.
So you're still doing your tap clinics? And
oh, yeah, once in a while, when time permits.
Do you enjoy passing your knowledge on?
I do, but it's a lot harder than performing, because I'm more of a performer than a teacher, and everything I teach is physical. I can't break it down properly, so if I teach a class, two classes for say an hour and 15 minutes each, I'm constantly moving and dancing for 2.5 hours.
What do you still want to accomplish in your life?
I don't know. I'd like to keep on doing what I'm doing. I have that much fun and enjoyment in it.
Well, we sure want to see you keep on doing what you're doing, because you're the best.
Well, thank you so much. You're very generous, and I'll accept that.
Our special guest is every songwriter's dream singer, and she's been a favorite with the Lawrence Welk Orchestra since she joined the show back in 1969. Please welcome Ralna English.
Well, thanks, Mary Lou. That was awfully nice.
Well, thank you, Ralna. Does looking at this show bring back any memories for you?
You know, it does bring back memories. That most of my memories are good, but this time in my life was a tough time. This was done in 1980. 80 and 81, I had a lot of stuff going on, a lot of emotional stuff in my life going on, so I remember all that, but it was a good show, wasn't it?
It sure is
a good show.
Well, this has been an especially gratifying time for you in your life. You just had a special of your very own, Ralna English from My Heart, air
yes.
nationally on public television.
I've come a long way since 1980.
How did that come about?
And I have such a happy life. And, well, the special, you know, we worked on this for over a year, Mary Lou, and the idea came about because I did a concert at the Sundome in Phoenix with a huge symphony orchestra, and they had these big screens on either side of the stage projecting me performing. And Susie Dowdy, the national publicist, longtime national publicist with the for the Lawrence Welk television show on OETA, was there that evening backstage, and she was watching it on the monitors from backstage. And she said when she saw it, she just knew that it had to be a PBS TV special. And I said, yeah, right. But, you know, it was amazing. A few months later, we got it. I talked to the conductor of the Charlotte Philharmonic, and he wanted to put me into their season schedule. We met with them. Susie and I met with him and his people, and we decided that we would do this concert. It would be called Ralna English from My Heart. We would tape it in Charlotte, North Carolina, with the wonderful Charlotte Philharmonic and Albert Mooring conducting. And we're going to have a huge gospel choir and dancers. And then we kind of wanted to test the waters, so we went to a couple of PBS national meetings to see how they would, you know, if they would accept something like this or how they would receive it if we were to do this. So, and they were very encouraging. I was so thrilled. And really, when the good folks at PBS Fundraising decided to help us fund this, it was just, it was wonderful. But then we went to, came to OETA and asked Bill Thrash and Bob Allen if they would be creative consultants, and went to my good friend Bob Krogstad, who did all the orchestrating for the choir and the symphony and the Philharmonic, and went to Rose Weiss, our wonderful longtime costumer with the Welk Show, to see if she'd help me get some costumes. And we did the show in one take, three acts.
That had to be a nerve-wracking day.
It was a nerve-wracking day, Mary Lou. I've never experienced anything quite like it. But, you know, I walked out on that stage, and the audience was overwhelming, really. I saw my longtime fans filling up the first two rows in the front, and everybody in the whole audience began to stand, even up in the balcony, when I walked out on stage.
Oh, what a feeling.
And it was like a gust of wind just blew me over. I could hardly go on. I really mean it. But it was a very magical time for me.
Well, you were also the executive producer on the special, so that
had to be a learning experience.
It was a learning experience, you know, from producing.
I was executive producer and Susie was producer, and we worked so well together. Actually, the real work began the next day because we stayed over in North Carolina for 10 days to do the editing. And then we came back a month later for another week to edit some more. And then, of course, we had to get the pledge event going. So we came here to OETA, and dear Bob Allen and Bill Thrash did such a fantastic job on the virtual, the pledge event for the fundraisers for all the PBS stations. So, it was just a grand time.
What did this all teach you about yourself?
You know, that it takes a lot of people to pull something off like this, and that I was able to actually hold up under this and do it myself, you know, but with all the people that were involved, you know, my Welk family, a lot of them, and then OETA family were so helpful to me, and it really touched my heart that they were so willing to help me and make this happen and make this so special.
Well, as a thank you gift, you and your sisters put together the Ralna English Family Cookbook. Now, I know when the English girls get together and food is involved, it's a labor of love. I know firsthand.
You do know firsthand. You've been there, haven't you? Well, you know what? We burned up the phone lines between Texas and California and Arizona. For 9 months, we felt like we'd had a baby, all three of us, because and we did. This cookbook was our baby. And, you know, it's filled with a lot of tradition, our family traditions, as far as cooking at the holiday season and the birthdays and the wonderful things that... I've got to tell you, my Aunt Pearl is a baker, and my mom's sister, and Aunt Pearl, in the second and third acts of my special, I wear her earrings, if you watch it, and I've got her earrings on today. These are a little different, but they match my little top, and so I decided to wear those today for Aunt Pearl. It's for you, Aunt Pearl, but she was a wonderful baker, and my mother was a great cook.
Your coconut cake recipe, there's a great story that goes with that.
You know what? I was a little girl, and I can still remember. I was about 10 years old, and Mother started making that cake, and we'd moved to Lubbock, the big city, you know, from Spur. And Mother started, she got a coconut from the grocery store. She broke it open. We drank the milk from the coconut that morning, and then she started grating the coconut and preparing her beautiful big white cake that she made with an orange filling. And all through the day, we would keep coming back into the kitchen to watch her create this fabulous work of art.
Whole day
of it was a work of art. And then when she finally had it finished, we just wanted to look at it. Oh. You know, we couldn't wait to taste it, but we really just wanted to sit and admire it because Mother worked so hard, you know, and it was such a special time. And we had a lot of special times like that when I was growing up. My mother was a wonderful cook, and I hope everybody enjoys
this. So are you.
Oh, thank you.
Jane and Sharon.
Jane is a fabulous, she's like a gourmet cook, and then Sharon is a great baker like Aunt Pearl, you know, we're very proud of our little cookbook.
We've all watched Julie grow up on the show over the years, the Christmas shows when you'd bring her on. What's she doing now?
Oh, we're so proud of her, Guy and I. I just can't tell you how proud we are of her. We think teachers need to be paid at least as much as basketball players. I mean, you know, I'm not even talking football here, you know, just basketball or whatever. But she's a great teacher. She taught kindergarten this year. And next year she's going to teach first grade. And when she started out this year, you know, a lot of her kids didn't even know how to hold a pencil in their hand. They didn't know their last names. And she has brought these children so far. And we're so proud of her because her class has just come up and learned so much this year. And I saw it with my own eyes in the last couple of weeks I went to visit her class. And they're just lovely, lovely children. And she's done such a phenomenal job to get them prepared for first grade. And we're just proud of her. Can you tell?
Not at all. How are you liking life in Arizona?
This lifestyle that I have for myself in Arizona is so different from any other that I ever imagined in my life. I didn't know that you could have this kind of a life. And my life is so beautiful.
How do you see the next chapter of your life?
I just have more of good things, more of these wonderful things that have come into my life. And it's such a late date. You know, here I am, you know, in my 60s, and all this is happening to me. But, I have a real sweet person in my life. I'm just blessed. I'm totally blessed right now. God has really, really blessed me in my life.
Well, that's how we feel about you. Thanks for being here, Ralna.
Thanks, honey. I love you.
Love you too, dear. Hey, Guy.
Hey, Mary Lou. We were the 70s kids, weren't we?
We sure were.
You and I started in 1970.
What do you think when you look back at this show from 1976?
Well, what do I think about? I think about 1976 when we took a very memorable trip together. That's what I think about. We went to Europe, went all over Europe. We had a great time. I love this show. I love Johnny Mercer's lyrics. I always thought he was one of the most clever lyricists that ever wrote, you know, writing things from Moon River to I'm an Old Cowhand, things like Jeepers Creepers, and then Charade. He was a great lyricist, and I've always admired his work, so I enjoyed this show.
Well, the last time we got together, we talked all about your career in show business, but now you're in politics. How did you get from the Lawrence Welk Show to the world of politics?
Yikes. Well, let's see. How did I do that? It wasn't easy. I moved back to Mississippi about a year after my old friend Trent Lott had gotten elected to the United States Senate. He'd been in House of Representatives for 16 years, eight terms before that. And I'd always participated in his campaigns, you know, from the time he was elected in 1972. So I was back in Mississippi, and he'd been trying to run his state offices out of Washington. And he needed somebody on the ground in Mississippi to do it. It just wasn't working. So he just out of the blue called me one day and said, hey, I need somebody down there to supervise my state offices. Would you be interested? And I said, good heavens, Trent, I don't know anything about politics. I said, I've been in show business for 20 years. He just looked at me and smiled and said, you'll do fine. I didn't know really what he meant by that. I think he insinuated there was a lot of similarity between politics and show business.
You think?
I'm here to tell you, there's not a whole lot of similarity. I found out politics is a lot more work for a lot less money.
So what exactly does running a state office entail?
Well, you know, that's a real good question, as they say. Most people think congressional offices are campaign offices. They think mm-hmm. people, that's where they do their political campaign. Well, not at all. As a matter of fact, it's illegal to do campaign operations out of an office that's paid for by you, the taxpayer. So anyhow, each member of Congress, they have their office in Washington, and then they have offices in their districts in the state. With the senators, they have to cover the whole state. So we've got four offices in Mississippi. We did have five, we closed one. But in the state offices, we do what is called constituent service work. Whereas in the Washington office, they deal mainly with legislation. Now, constituent service work is mainly helping people try to get through this unbelievable bureaucracy that we've built over the years and through the red tape of working with federal agencies like the Social Security Administration, Veterans Administration, Internal Revenue, things like that. That's basically what we do is our staff tries to help people that just can't get anywhere. They've run into a brick wall. We're supposed to only deal with the federal agencies. Of course, Trent's motto has always been, if anybody calls this office for anything, you try to help them. So we do. And on top of that, I supervise the state offices and try to keep us all on the same page with the Washington office. And I spend a lot of my time going around the state representing Trent at events that he can't attend and sitting in on meetings and letting him know what's even happening.
He couldn't have a better representative.
I don't know about that, but it's been a real good experience for me. I really enjoyed it.
You have a wonderful family.
What's
happening with them?
I have, I don't know how God blessed me so this late in life. To have met my wife, Sis. That sounds funny, doesn't it?
It sounds beautiful.
Here's my wife, Sis. Her name is actually Sarah, but no people have called her Sis all her life. But she's a registered nurse, and my friends kid me. They say, well, in your old age, you'd go find your own personal nurse. But she is a wonderful person, and she is she's quite a talented gal. She's been in administration in surgical services for, I don't know, 30, 35 years, and which is a very stressful job, as you can imagine, running operating rooms and everything that goes with them. But a couple of years ago, she felt like she just needed a change. She'd done it too long, and she was kind of stressed out. So she's moved over to working at the Cancer Center, the Hederman Cancer Center. She's Director of Program Development at the Hederman Cancer Center at Baptist Hospital in Jackson, and she works with cancer patients and their families and helps them when they're diagnosed. She gives a class, tells them what to expect. She just kind of guides them through the treatment process, and you can imagine she's wonderful at it. And now people come up to me all the time and say, your wife's an angel. I say, yeah, I know it. And we have beautiful grandchildren. Sis has got daughter Dawn has three beautiful children, Blair, who's 14, and Mary Margaret, who's 6, and Tori, who's 3. We don't get to see enough of them, but and then we have sister son Hunter, who works in Washington, and my daughter Julie in Phoenix, who've yet to get married. So we're going to be looking at grandkids.
You're going to be busy for a while.
We're going to be going to see grandkids in wheelchairs if we don't get going here.
Well, you've got a brand new CD out.
I did. People have been asking me for years to record a patriotic CD, a lot of the songs that I sang, like God Bless the USA, and the song I sang at the presidential inauguration in 05, Let the Eagle Soar. I finally got that thing recorded last year.
Oh, fabulous.
And it's done really well, and I'm proud of it. It came out really better than I expected, let's put it that way. Still most of the notes come out of this croaky old voice. And I thank God for that.
Never a croaky old voice. Do you have a favorite Welk story?
A favorite Welk story? Well, heavens above, I'm sure there's so many of them we've talked about. We need to just sit around sometime and tell Lawrence Welk stories. My favorite Lawrence Welk, this is personal for me and for Ralna. Back when we were working those 4 days a week and we'd go catch an airplane on Thursday night after recording and go somewhere and do a public appearance Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and then fly back and to the studio to do the TV show. We'd done that for 2 or 3 years, and we were tired. And we were on one of those one-nighter things we'd go on, those 3 weeks of one-nighters. And Lawrence looked at us one day, and I guess he could see we were really worn out, and he came up and got whoever was sitting in the seat on the airplane next to Roland, let him sit there, and he talked to us, and he said, "Kids, you look a little tired." And we said, "Yes, Mr. Welk." We said, we're running all over the country working on weekends, anyhow, to make a long story short, he said, "Well, here's my suggestion to you. Work less and ask for more money." And we did, and it worked. So I've always thought that the man was wise.
Thank you, Lawrence.
Thank you, Lawrence.
And thank you, Guy. This has been such a great time with you.
Thank you, Mary Lou. It's always good to be with you.
Well, the occupations of my special guest are many and varied. He's a singer, a dancer, a marimba player, a drummer, a choreographer, and the associate producer of The Lawrence Welk Show. Please welcome Jack Immel. Hey,
Mary.
Jack. Well, what do you think looking back at this show from 1968?
Oh, the show we did in 68?
Yes.
Well, you know, first of all, every show I see brings back memories. But, you know, I would always try to find, you know, songs that are a little different. And I found this song called I'm a Sound Effects Man.
Well, Lawrence always loved showcasing young talent. When you were the new kid on the block, did he ever give you any coaching on your solos?
Well, you know, he hired me right on the air in 1957. And he hired me more or less as a marimba soloist and tap dancer. And in those days, we would rehearse the music for the television show at the Aragon Ballroom. So when it was my turn to rehearse with the band, Lawrence had a habit of maybe wanting to make some changes on the solo I was going to play that week. So he'd make these changes, and he'd say, "Now, Jack, why don't you work on these changes, and we'll come back to your number a little bit later in rehearsal." Well, that's fine. But where do I take a marimba and go in a corner somewhere and practice these changes he wanted without disturbing the rehearsal? So I finally decided the best place for me to practice was in the men's room. So I went to Lawrence and I says, "Lawrence, when you're ready to do my number again, you know, rehearse my number, I'll be in the men's room." He said, "Okay." So when the band would take a break, he'd come in the men's room, see how it was doing. In fact, he would make some more changes. And anybody in the band wanted to use the men's room, he'd stop me and say, "Boys, you can't come in here right now. I'm rehearsing with Jack Immel."
Now, I'm just glad they had two men's rooms at the Aragon Ballroom.
Now, a marimba is not the easiest instrument to take on the road.
No.
You must have had a few adventures with that.
In the beginning, I did. You know, the airlines in the early days couldn't handle the weight and the cargo space that they do now. And the marimba weighed about 200 pounds. And when you cased it up, it had four big cases. And so Lawrence come to me, and he said, Jack, he said, we may have a little trouble taking your marimba on this first road trip. He said, because of the weight of the instrument and the cargo space. And when we'd go out on tour, we'd play about 12 towns, and they were all major cities. So he said, would you mind if we rented a marimba in each town? Well, I didn't see anything wrong with that, playing all these major cities. Things went pretty well the first three or four days, and then the promoter, Bill Daly, who was a wonderful guy, Bill and I became real good friends later on in years, but it was his job to find a marimba for me in each town. And he said, tomorrow, Jack, we may have a little trouble with your marimba. He says, the only one we could find in this whole town was one that was specially made for a guy that was 6'10" tall. And he says, if I were you, I would go over to the building tomorrow early and check this instrument out and make sure it's going to be okay for you. So I went over to the building, and the keyboard came clear up to here on me.
I can see you now.
And when I'd play it, my elbows, it looked like I was going to fly away any minute, you know. Uh-huh. But I worked at it and worked at it, and finally I got it down to where I could probably get through the number, for one night anyway. Now, in those days, I would play the first chorus on a marimba, and then I would jump over my marimba. And for some reason, I just hadn't thought about jumping over this thing. I had been so worried about hitting the right notes that it just didn't dawn on me that I got to jump over this thing. So now we're doing the concert. I'm playing the first chorus, and I'm about halfway through the chorus, and I'm saying to myself, oh no, I got to jump over this thing. I understand the guys in the band were placing bets whether or not I was going to make it or not. But the only thing I can say, Mary, is I was 24 years old. There were 15,000 people out there. I got Lawrence smiling at me in the corner. I got the wonderful Lawrence Welk band back of me. I'm pretty sure the Lord was on my side. The adrenaline was going, and I made it. In fact, I almost landed in the front row of the audience.
Lawrence was such a giant in the industry.
Oh, yeah, he was a superstar.
He was wonderful to his audience, whether it was on stage or in a coffee shop in the morning before he got on the bus. You had a personal experience in Milwaukee one time.
Yeah, I think it was Milwaukee. The hotel we're staying at was only two blocks from where we're doing the show. And usually you take a bus, you know. But it was close enough that most of the guys walked. And the show's at 8 o'clock, and I decided to go over a little early and practice. So I'm in the lobby around 6 o'clock, going over to the building, and I run into Lawrence. And Lawrence says, where are you going? I said, well, I thought I'd go over to the building and practice a little bit. He said, well, I'll walk along with you. Now, remember, this is only two blocks we're talking about. This was the longest two blocks I've ever walked in my entire life. We couldn't take but two or three steps that somebody, you know, would want his autograph. But it didn't stop there. He would hold a conversation with him. Where are you from? Do you watch the show every week? How do you like this show? How do you like that show? Here's Jack Imel. Would you like his autograph? you know, it would take a couple minutes. And then she'd take three more steps. Well, hello, how are you? And the same thing again. We got to the building. We left at 6 o'clock. We got to the stage door entrance at 7:15. And it was just two blocks. But what was amazing was how a man with his reputation, and he was a superstar, had that much humility. And because superstars just don't do that. Even the nice guys, the nice superstars, they're always, they're going to pull up in a limousine, probably with a police escort. Some of them even have bodyguards, but not Lawrence. He walked those two blocks and signed. And, you know, it was as important to him, I think, to sign autographs and talk to these people as it was to perform on the stage.
I understand.
We would play buildings. We played the Roop Arena. Adolph Roop Arena is in Kentucky. It holds 25,000 people. And we filled that place up. And we even put seats, you can put seats on the playing floor. So we could get another 3,000 or 4,000 on the floor. Now, if you have seats completely around this arena, you have the stage at one end. So back of the stage, you've got about 3,000 or 4,000 feet seats. And they would sell out. They'd sell those seats back of the band. And they were told when they bought the tickets. They said, now all you're going to see are the backs of these people's heads. They didn't care. They bought those seats just to see, because they could see us backstage.
Yeah.
And Lawrence said, would say, now, kids, make sure that those people that got bad seats, make sure you go over and talk to them and sign autographs. And but that's the way he came up, you know. It was hard, tough for him, you know, coming off a farm, the fourth grade, you know. For him to be accepted by millions of people, he never forgot that,
yeah.
You know. He had a desire. He told me that, if I can get this out, you know, I get sort of emotional when I talk about him. He took a bunch of pitchforks, and he would put them in the ground in the barnyard and pretend that it was an orchestra.
Wow.
So he had a dream, and that was going to be as obvious as the man was going to make it.
Yeah. Quite a guy.
Yeah, you know, you hear that old saying, they threw the mold away when they made him. Well, that certainly holds true with him.
Well, Jack, you have been married to a wonderful woman.
Sure have.
For 54 years.
54 years.
Norma.
Norma?
What's the secret?
Well, I don't know. We met on a Ferris wheel, and we were in the sixth grade, and I'm not trying to make a joke out of this, but we've been going around together ever since. But we just hit it off, and she loves the work I'm in, and she loves to be around the people that are in the show. And, you know, the wives all know each other, and she's a real good friend of Ken Delo's wife in Maryland, and she loves Joanne Castle, you know, because she's so much fun, you know. And she loves the show. She's a fan. She's the first one to sit down and watch the show. Get in here, Jack, the show's on. You're going to miss the, you know. And she's put up with a lot for me, too. I mean, I used to practice the marimba 3 or 4 hours a day. It drove me nuts. of course, the neighbor's nuts. But she never complained about it.
Thank you so much.
Thank
you. For being with us. The Lennon sisters were America's sweethearts. And my special guest is the firstborn of that illustrious quartet. Please welcome Dee Dee Lennon.
Hi, Mary Lou.
Hi, Dee Dee. I'm so glad you're here.
Thanks. I'm glad to be here.
What do you think when you look back at this show from 1967?
Oh, my. I look at all those wonderful faces of people that are gone and people that we worked with for all those years and were so good to us. We were little girls when we started, and all the band members were like brothers and uncles and took care of us. And I looked at those faces and, oh, it kind of brings tears, but it brings a lot of happiness too.
Well, when you did join the show in 1955, America sort of thought of you collectively as those beautiful little girls.
Mm-hmm.
But you were actually 16.
You were a young woman. I just turned 16.
Was that hard for you?
It was hard in some ways. I had just turned 16. I was a junior in high school. And Janet was 9, and so when they dressed us for the show, they tried to keep us young, and I sometimes had to wear things that I probably would not have worn off the show. But they kept us, you know, looking like a quartet, which we were, and it was hard. Sometimes we sang songs, like on Easter. We sang Here Comes Peter Cottontail and skipped around to Toadstool. But my friends at school knew that was my job. You know, we were the oldest of 11 children, and we had to have a job to help out, and that was my job. So I did it, and I enjoyed it, and met a lot of nice people. But sometimes it was a little embarrassing.
Well, Peggy and Kathy and Janet all met their future husbands on the show. How did you and Dick meet?
Well, thanks to his brother Jimmy, his younger brother Jimmy, who had asthma. They moved from Buffalo, New York. The doctor said, you better move from Buffalo and go to California or Arizona. So his family of 8, Dick was the oldest of 8, moved to Venice, California, and moved across the street from my grandmother Lennon. And every one of his 8 brothers and sisters went to school with one of my brothers and sisters. So we were bound to meet, even though Dick was 2 years ahead of me in high school. And I dated his younger brother, who was my age. But that's how we met. And I was 17 when we started dating. And I knew right away he was the one for me. So that's how we met.
And you were married on the anniversary.
Yes, we had our first date was October 16th of 1957, and we were married October 16th of 1960.
Now, that sounded like the social event of the century. You have to tell us about
that.
It
was. Well, because Dick was the oldest of 8, and I was the oldest of 11, and we had big families on both sides. He was working for the telephone company in California and had all these friends. We had all the friends at the Welk Theater. And so we just had so many people at our wedding. But at that time, well, I think there were close to 1,000. It was a lot of people. But we couldn't let people, we didn't want to hurt anybody's feelings, you know.
Sure.
So we invited everyone we knew. And it was, at that time, you could not get married on a Sunday in the Catholic Church. And we wanted to have this big Catholic wedding because we'd been raised Catholic. And so we had to get a dispensation from the Cardinal at that time because the Lawrence Welk Show was taped on Saturdays. And so I couldn't get married on a Sunday. No one would have been able to come. So we got the dispensation and we were married on a Sunday, which was really, really unusual.
And your reception, I understand, was
at the Aragon Ballroom.
A familiar
ballroom.
Spot.
It was. And the owner of the Aragon Ballroom told us he would like for us to use it for our reception. And so it was really beautiful. We were very, very fortunate.
Now, you told me you'd always wanted to be a wife and mother.
Mm-hmm. I did. My whole life, that's all I ever wanted to do. And that's what I basically am, and I just love it. When we got married, we wanted to have a family right away. And I was told I probably couldn't have any children, so we adopted. And Mary, darling little Mary, we saw her at an hour and a half old, and we brought her home in a day and a half. And then 9 months and 3 days later, we had Dee Dee, and 18 months later, we had Tommy. So I had three in 27 months after being told I would never have any.
Well, at one time, we more than just maternity leave. You actually left the show for a while.
I did. I left when I got married. I didn't want to perform anymore, and Dick and I talked it over, and he was working, and we just said, no, I just want to stay home. And we did that for 2.5 years, and then when we adopted Mary, Dick's company, the phone company, went on strike, and we were afraid that they would not let us have final adoption papers if neither of us was working. And he was on strike for several months. And then I found out I was pregnant, and we said, we just got to keep our baby, you know, our Mary. So Mr. Welk called, and he heard about it from my sisters, and he called, and he said, would you consider just coming back and doing just the Saturday shows, the TV shows? I said, yes, I'd do that. I said, but I don't want to travel. And he said, no, you don't have to travel. Just come back and do the TV shows. And that's how I came back on.
Well, at one time, you and Peggy were actually pregnant at the same time.
We were. She had Chris and I had Tommy, and they were 6 weeks apart. And at that time we were working at the old Welk Theater. It was in black and white, and they switched us over to the Hollywood Palace while they changed the studio to color. So we were at the Hollywood Palace, and the Hollywood Palace was not built for TV, and all the dressing rooms were way upstairs, and Peggy and I were pregnant, and it was really hard. There were no elevators, and
I remember them.
Yes, and so there was a lot of stairs to go up and down. And so the crew, God bless Eddie Holland and all of them, they built us our own dressing room, and they called it the Stork Club. And they painted a stork on the front, and Peg and I've got pictures of the two of us, and that was our dressing room. And that was just so sweet that they would even think about that, you know.
Well, you were the firstborn in the family, not mm-hmm. just of the Lennon sisters. What was it like to be the oldest of 11 children?
I loved it. I really did. I know some people think it's a chore and you get a lot of responsibility, but I think because I always loved children, and Mom was so wonderful sharing the kids with us. I mean, she seemed like she was always pregnant and she was always bringing home a baby, but we just loved the babies. It was just a wonderful thing to experience each and every one of those children. And the last 8 brothers and sisters were born in 10 years, so, and I was in high school for most of that, and so Mom was just, it was wonderful. We got to just share the babies.
You told me there was a time you were like your dad's boy.
I was, because he had four girls first and wanted a boy. So I was his boy, and I used to go play golf with him early in the morning before school when I was 6. We went to every UCLA football game, Rams football game. I was his boy, and I really enjoyed that. I really thank him for giving me a great love of sports, because now Dick and I have that together.
You were always a California girl. Was it tough to make that move to Branson?
You know, we thought it would be tougher than it was. When they asked us if we would come, when Larry called us and asked us if we would go, everybody thought Dick and I wouldn't do it, because I was teaching kindergarten at the time and I loved it. I was home by noon every day, and we get on, and he was retired, and we would get on our bikes and ride down to the beach. And we were just loving it. But when Larry said, well, your kids could come and perform too, because we said we don't want to leave our kids. So we asked our kids, and they said, let's give it a shot for 1 year and see what happens. So we came to Branson, and Dee Dee and Tommy both ended up marrying people from there and starting families. Well, you just don't leave your grandchildren.
What did Lawrence teach you?
I think he taught me to always do what you're supposed to do when you're supposed to do it. He always, you were ready, you did your job, you were prepared, you couldn't not be prepared. You know, it was, this is when we're going to do it, and you had to know every line of every, he didn't have cue cards for us. I think he prepared me to just say, hey, this is my life, do the best you can do with it. Be ready for whatever happens.
Is there anything you'd still like to accomplish that you haven't done yet?
Oh, I think I've done so many things. I've been so lucky. I got to teach kindergarten, which I really enjoyed. But if I had to say one thing, besides being a grandma now and just loving all that, I think in the very, very back of my mind, someday I'd like to open a little bookshop with a bakery upstairs or something, and I'd like to have people come by and read old books, and I'd like to bake the things, and I don't know, just visit with people. I think that would be way in the back of my mind someday.
Well, I'd be there in a heartbeat. I'm so glad you were here today.
Oh, thank you, Mary Lou.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
The entire country fell in love with my special guest when she and her sisters made their debut on the Lawrence Welk Show back on Christmas Eve in 1955. Please welcome Janet Lennon.
Hi.
Hi, Janet.
How are you?
So good. So glad to have you here.
Thank you.
I think this could possibly be my very favorite Lawrence Welk show. It must bring back memories for you.
Oh, it's just the best. It's one of my favorite shows, too. You know, the obvious thing is that the set was so amazing. Our art director, Chuck Kuhn, could just do the most beautiful sets. But this particular one encompassed the entire orchestra and the production area. And everyone was in costume, including everyone in the band. I'm sure that Rosie Weiss, our costume lady, went all over LA or the world looking for berets for everyone. But they looked so good, and it seemed to me every time we did one of these wonderful shows, just the atmosphere around the theater was just so much fun. And people, some of the guys in the band and Charlotte from the band would get to dress up in costumes and be a character in one of the scenes. And just the whole atmosphere was so much fun. We had so much fun.
And Peggy and that poodle.
Well, Peg loved singing that song to the poodle, but as I recall in rehearsals, the poodle wasn't potty trained, if you will, and had an accident on Peggy's clothing, and she wasn't all that happy about that.
A memorable experience.
Yes.
I loved the French lesson that you did with Aladdin, and you and he always had such great chemistry together.
Just loved Laddie. You know, before we joined the Lawrence Welk Show, our grandpa had died, and he was an old song and dance man, and we just loved him. And Laddie seemed to just fill that space in our hearts. And when we first met him, you know, he's such a big, wonderful, bigger-than-life guy, and he told us that he spoke 12 languages, which I think that he did, and that his real name was Aladdin Abdullah Ahmed Anthony Palante, and that he was from New York City. And like later, Bob Lito took us aside and he said, you know, he's Tony Palante from Plainfield, New Jersey. But he was just this wonderful ham actor that loved every bit of performing. And there was just a connection between all of us, really, with Laddie. And he and his wife never had children, and they would be over to our house, and they just absolutely loved us, and we him. He was wonderful to work with.
You also got to dance a lot on the show through the years. Did you ever want to be a dancer or study dance?
I always loved dancing. I studied dancing for about several weeks when I was about 6 years old, and we were little and we weren't performing yet, so we couldn't afford the dance lessons anymore, but I always loved dancing. My mother was actually a dance teacher when she was 16. That's what she did her summers to make money. So she taught us little things around the house, and I always loved dancing. And then when Cubby O'Brien and Jack Immel and Bobby Burgess and a guy named Bo Wagner and Art Duncan, of course, on our show, they all tap dance. They would give me lessons all the time, so I really got lessons from the best, and I still would love to be in the back chorus on Broadway somewhere.
You could. Believe me, you could.
Thanks.
I remember when I came on the show and we started traveling, I would hear stories about how the Lennon sisters were afraid to fly. What was that about?
Well, we weren't in the beginning. It was sort of an adventure when we would go on the road with the band. We'd get in the plane, and it was great. And, you know, people did look like ants. And, I mean, it was really fun. But we flew so much, we were on the road so much, that we were, you know, it was obvious we were going to have some bad plane rides. And some of those chartered planes that we had, you know, back in the 1950s were pretty rickety, and I can remember one time landing somewhere and the airplane window just kind of fell into my lap, and we were very lucky to be on the ground at the time. But so it's sort of, I don't know, we just sort of don't really like flying. We do it because you
have
to.
I think a special story about a big storm where you were late for a concert?
Oh, we flew into Dallas one day. We were getting there just in the evening, just before our concert at the big arena there. It was the whole Lawrence Welk Orchestra and show. And there was a tornado hit the Dallas airport. And the crew from the flight tower had evacuated. And so our pilot had no connection with anyone, and it was so black he didn't know if we were right side up or what side up we were, because it was so dark outside and so bumpy. He said he prayed and he pulled up, and luckily we went up, and we ended up going to Little Rock and getting on a plane several hours later, coming back, and there were thousands of people in their arena waiting for us.
Still,
and I think
waiting.
We didn't start our show till, you know, 9:30 or 10 that night, but they all stayed. And we did it in our street clothes, because our costumes, you know, hadn't been ironed or anything. So that was really something. We had some good experiences with
quite
those
a testament
people.
To the Lawrence Welk audience as well.
Yes, that was great. We had fun. That was really fun.
Now, you told me that you and Kathy used to take your dolls along on the trip so that you have a little bit of home with you.
Kathy and I had some favorite dolls that our mom and our grandmother had made for us when I was 3 and Kathy was 6. They were little rag dolls about this big. Mine was blonde and Kathy's was brunette with embroidered faces and yarn hair. And we just loved these dolls so much. They meant so much to our childhood. And we had a little trunk that we each had a little trunk that we kept our doll in, and we took them on every road trip with us. And at night, we would put them in their little white nighties, and they'd sleep with us in the hotel rooms. It was just like taking a little bit of home with us.
Well,
so in later years, she and I had always dreamed of doing something together when we grew up, and we just decided that those dolls meant so much to us growing up, and appealed so much to our nurturing side, mm-hmm. that we wanted to try to reproduce them for children, for little girls right now. We felt like maybe there was a little hole in the toy industry right now for a nurturing doll, a doll where it doesn't talk and it doesn't wear makeup and it doesn't wear flashy clothes. It's just something that a child can love. And so we decided to reproduce those little dolls. And we have, Kathy and I growing up called each other best pals. And so we've called our whole product line best pals. And we reproduce these darling dolls exactly right down to the vintage fabric. And as we go on and it gets more and more popular, we have recorded CDs of our favorite childhood songs and have a new line of multicultural dolls coming out. And so it's really catching on. And
I understand you're going to do storybooks as well?
We are. We're doing storybooks. And we're really lucky. We have such talent in our family. My husband, John, who was in music his whole life, and a lot of people have seen him conducting the Lawrence Welk Orchestra, is now a photographer, which was always one of his wonderful hobbies. And so he has a photography studio. He does all of our publicity photos and all of our product shots. My daughter-in-law, Amy, who works for him, does our graphic arts and photo touch-ups. Peggy's daughter, Betsy Cathcart, runs our office. Our son, Bill, runs our warehouse. And another son does all of our video editing. And my daughter, Kristen, works for our local television station. And her crews will come and videotape us. So it's all in-house. And we're just absolutely loving it. It's a very, very special, sensitive project for us. And so far, it's going really, really
and
well.
It really is a family affair.
Yeah, it really, really is. And my granddaughters are the models, and they do our product shots with the dolls, and they just love it. And they go on stage with us and sing and have sung on our CDs.
I remember
and,
that.
And every year on stage, they come and sing in our Christmas show with us. So,
how is it being a grandma?
Well, I absolutely love it, and as we speak, we're expecting number 7, so we just love it. And when we moved to Branson, I never expected our 5 children to move back here, because they were L.A. kids, and slowly each of them and their families moved here, and so all of our children and all of our grandchildren live in Branson with us, and it's wonderful. We have Sunday night dinners every Sunday night, and It's the joy of my life. It really is. It's the love that you have for your children, and yet you have not the responsibility of having to raise them. You can just love them and play with them, and it's just terrific. We love
it. So it's easier being a grandma.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And you were working when you were being a mom.
I was, and we tried to curtail our working activities when we did have small children. We ended up doing a lot of work in Las Vegas, where we could only do concentrated work for 3 or 4 weeks and then have several months off. And that was great because our children all grew up together. All these 14 little cousins would be at Caesar's Palace together with us. And they learned to roller skate in the halls of Caesar's Palace. And they learned to swim in the swimming pool from their Aunt Kathy at Caesar's Palace. So that, it's been a wonderful family experience. They've all been involved at all times. And so it's been a wonderful time for us.
Well, I think we've all grown up together. And it's yes. been wonderful time and wonderful memories.
Thank you, Mary Lou.
Thanks
it has been
so
for me
much
too.
For being here.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Mary.
Oh, we're
nice
so glad you're here.
Thank you.
Well, this show from 1968 must bring back some memories.
Wow, it really did. And when I got a chance to look at it, just so many memories of great people and how wonderful people were. Steve Smith, what a voice, you know? I mean, it was just listening to him and then doing Where Are the Words, what my sisters and I sang, because they had done a Dr. Doolittle special and we had just come off doing the Ed Sullivan Show. And we had learned that song for the Ed Sullivan Show. And it was, Anthony Newley was on the show. So we got a chance to really get a feel of Dr. Doolittle. And that was very special, and then be able to do it on the show. And as Mr. Welk said, and that surprised me, because I forgot when I looked back and saw the show that he said we had gone to the premiere. And then I remembered we took all our little brothers, because I said, how many tickets can you use? And we brought all our little brothers and sisters to it, so they got to see Dr. Doolittle. It was pretty special.
Now, how long after this show did you get your own show on ABC?
You know, I was looking at that, and it's funny because when I heard us sing Quanta Lagusta, I said, little did we know, it was, you know, got to get going, where are we going? And we were down to just doing one show a month at that time, and then ABC had asked us, when we didn't work out a schedule with Mr. Welk, ABC had asked us to do our own television show for ABC. And we did the special that following fall, and then we did our show the next year, because Jimmy Durante was our special guest on the show for ABC, and they said, that it worked so well. What if we have a regular show, Lennon Sisters, and Jimmy Durante's on it every week? And we did that and had a great time with him, and it allowed us to work with people like the greats, Jack Benny and Bob Hope and Sammy Davis and George Burns, and because they all loved Jimmy so much, and they came on the show as guests, and at such young ages, to be able to work with these incredible vaudevillian pros was very special.
What an amazing time.
Yeah, it was an amazing time.
Now, is it true? Did you really want to be a secretary when you were a little girl?
You know, people ask me that. I did. I always did. I'm very organized. I mean, ask my sisters. It drives them crazy. Yeah, you know. And it's like making sure you have the earrings and the shoes and what matches and what doesn't. And I always wanted to do that. Because I always felt you could get your desk clean, everything, and you could lock the door and never think about it again. In performing and entertainment, you never have that 5 o'clock, turn the lock, and everything's okay. And I did get that fulfilled I worked in my husband's chiropractic office for about 5 years as office manager. I loved it. I was just running the place.
A dream come true.
It was, and I locked that door and said, let's go to dinner, and I didn't have to think about what key to sing in.
Well, you've also become the Lennon family historian.
I have. I always kind of have loved background. I love that our grandmother was a ballerina from Germany, and our mom's grandmother is Mexican and was born in Los Angeles, fifth generation. And I've kept pictures through the years of everything Lennon family history. And I've run across something. I'm starting kind of a collection of old pictures and old recordings that we made, because I don't know if you knew, many, many, many years ago, you could have your own recording machine. And our great aunt, my grandmother's sister, was married to William Randolph Hearst's oldest son, George, and had these gifts they would send to us. And they sent us a record-making machine where you'd pull the black stuff off of the wax and everything, and we would record in our house. And I found some of those recordings. She always called us the Miracle Kids. Have the Miracle Kids make us a record and send it up. So that's why she sent us this machine. Well, something very special happened as I was going through them, and I wanted to make some CDs for my 11 brothers and sisters for Christmas to surprise them. I came across a record of me when I was in first grade. Our Catholic school, always at Christmas time, put on where you would tell this Christmas story. And it was called the Araceli, and my part was the Annunciation. And when, you know, the angel Gabriel sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, I'm like, I can still do it from first grade. And Daddy wanted me to record that and put it on a record. Well, what I found, which gets really emotional, is me on this record doing the Araceli, the Christmas song, and Daddy behind singing Ave Maria.
Oh.
And I found this record, I went, oh my gosh, because we have a few things of Daddy singing. He was a beautiful Irish tenor. And now I have that record that we're going to be making, and I'm going to surprise, if they don't see the show, my brothers and sisters with having copies of that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what treasure.
Oh, we have such wonderful treasures. We've been very blessed with so many people sending us pictures and stories, and so I have quite an archive in my house.
Your secretarial skills have come into good use.
It works. Yeah, it does.
Well, you and Janet have started a project that's really dear to your hearts.
This is a dream come true. When Janet and I were little, we always called each other best pals, and we were the best cowboys together, and we used to sit and sing to our favorite dolls, our rag dolls that were made for us by our grandmother Nana and our mom when Janet was just 3 and I was 6. And we loved those little dolls, took them on the road with us, with Mr. Welk, played with the dolls. And a few years ago, we decided to record a children's album, and we decided to reproduce the ragdolls, which we still have. I have them here.
The originals.
They're over 60 years old. I think they're 57 years old. Of the original dolls that were made for us by Nana and Mom.
And they're in beautiful shape.
They really are. We've loved them to death, and yet we've taken care of them. We've treasured them. And we really felt there was a hole in the toy industry for a simpler time, for little girls to stay longer, a little longer. And we thought that there would be an option for this kind of a rag doll again. And so we have reproduced them right down to the vintage fabric. Here they are in reproductions. And I know we've talked to so many of our loyal fans before about it, and they've been so thrilled with them. So these are our rag dolls. They're just really incredible. We are so proud, and this is something Jan and I are, oh, it takes so much time up, but it's a dream come through. It is something we have planned for so long, and it's here, it's happened. And it's kind of a tribute back to Mom, a Mom and Nana's spirits, or every one of these dolls, and to see them come and happen is so beautiful, and we've had an incredible reaction to them everywhere.
Oh. And your sister Peggy was involved in doing some of the original artwork.
She did. She did
the
original artwork on the Best Pals, the two little girls, and she wrote a little book about how we started as little best pals and grew up singing and decided to make rag dolls. And so she was involved, and Peg is a part of that has been kind of unique and special for it at the beginning.
Oh, it has to mean so much
to
you.
Oh, it does. It's incredible. Yes.
Well, now, you started out with the Kathy and Janet dolls.
Right.
But you've also branched out.
We are very excited about this. We have just come to, we've been wanting to do this from the beginning. We have multicultural dolls. So we have our same rag doll, but made in the different ethnic, for the children to be able to relate to what they are, to love little rag dolls. And this is Sophia. We just love her. Kind of my mother-in-law's name is Sophia. And this is after Mom. This is Isabel.
Oh.
And that's our mom's name and our grandmother's name. So here's our little Isabel. And the clothes are like from first grade, like Janet and my clothes. I mean, they really are. And this is Lily. We just loved Lily.
Oh.
So those are our three new dolls.
It has to be successful. There's so much love behind it.
There is. Thank you, Mary. Thank you very much.
What's next for you?
Oh, wow. We have a lot more product that is coming in, like I said, like these dolls and the pets and all. And then the Lennon sisters are continuing at the Welk Resort performing at Christmas time, a family special Christmas time. The Gatlin brothers with ourselves. We're doing a few concert tours, and we're very active in our fan club still. It's very active. And this is, we're in our 51st year of performing. We're not even 51 years old.
And here we
None
are.
None of us are.
You know, yeah, exactly. And to see these PBS specials going on, and I think I've said this before, what a tribute. What a tribute to, one, the man who started it, and to all the performers who, it's like being at the same school. We were all raised the same by the same That's papa. True. And we're on time. We know our schedule. We know our songs. The professionalism that this show brought to our years of now experience has been incredible and remarkable. And I think everyone along the way, meeting, being with all the performers, brings back just your heart is just full of all the love that started way back for us at Christmas Eve 1955.
We've all been so lucky to be together.
Haven't we?
And
haven't
thank we? You. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Mary. Love you.
Our special guest is the beautiful and multi-talented singer, dancer, actress, and producer, Mary Lou Metzger. Mary Lou, welcome. And did this program bring back some memories?
Oh, it certainly did. And in some ways, it was like I was seeing it for the first time. Back in the days when we taped these, we were all so invested in our own performance and so much to think about that I don't think I ever really had the perspective of it as a show. And I see Jim Hobson's direction and how creative it was. Chuck Kuhn, our set designer, and Jack Denton, our lighting designer. It was about fashion, so Rose Weiss hit a home run, and Roselle Friedland and her hairstyles that matched every costume. Our wonderful orchestra. When I heard Joe Lovotti and Neil Levang play, I just felt so fortunate to be part of this amazing group of people.
Well, let's go back to the beginning. How did you get into show business?
Well, when I was a little girl, on Saturday mornings, little girls would either go to the roller skating rink or to dancing school. And I was lucky enough to go to dancing school. And my tap teacher danced in 42nd Street with Dick Powell, and my ballet teacher was in the corps de ballet at Radio City Music Hall. So I had some good training, and then I did a little theater production of Guest in the House, and when you're doing one thing, you hear about other things. I sang on the Steel Pier in Atlantic City on the Tony Grant Stars of Tomorrow show. It was a children's show. And then I did a play called Guest in the House, where I was a little girl that tried to fly out the window. And someone's agent came to see them in the show and said they were looking for a little girl to go out on the national company of the Music Man. Hmm. And I went to New York and auditioned for that.
What was it like being on the road like that, and what age?
Well, I turned 11 on that trip, and for me it was a great adventure. We did 113 cities, 229 performances, and the cast was wonderful. The audiences were wonderful. My mom traveled with me. And to this day, I still have friendships with some of those people from those days.
Well, we're all wondering, Mary Lou, how did you really get on the Lawrence Welk show?
Well, I was in college at Temple University. I was a music major back in Philadelphia. And at the time, there was a show on the air called the All-American College Show that Arthur Godfrey hosted. Mm-hmm. And they would get talented kids from around the country, from the different colleges and universities, and showcase them on television. Well, I pulled a boy from one of the accompaniment classes at Temple University and auditioned, and they were lovely, and they said, "We're booked about 6 weeks ahead, but we'd love to use you." And I thought that was the nicest way of saying, "Don't call us, we'll call you," I'd ever heard. Well, about a week later, they called. Someone had canceled on them. And they said, "If we get you a ticket, can you come to California?" And I did. And my mom just happened to ride the train with one of our local assemblymen, Bob Hawkinson. And he'd gone to college with Myron Florin at Augustana College. And he said, "She should go to a taping while you're out there." And my mom and dad had had their first date to the Lawrence Welk Orchestra back in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So it was kind of a pilgrimage for me to go see the taping. Well, back in those days, if Lawrence ever saw anyone young in the audience, he would always go up to them and say, "Do you sing?" And I said, "As a matter of fact, I'm out here to do the college show." And he handed me a microphone, and without accompaniment, he said, "Sing something." And I sang, "How Are Things in Glockamora?" And he invited me back to his dressing room after the show. I thought I was going to get an autographed picture to take home to my mom and dad. And instead, I got an invitation to come down to the Palladium that Saturday night and sing with the band. And it had just happened that Norma had decided to stop traveling with the show. She was just going to do the television show, and he needed one more person for a 3-week engagement at Harris Club in Lake Tahoe. So I came out thinking I had a 3-week summer job, and he kept me.
That's a beautiful story. You mentioned your mom a couple of times. What impact would you say she's had on your career?
Oh my gosh. My mom is my heart when it comes to my career. When I was little, she would play the piano and accompany me on my auditions. She has been my strongest support, my sharpest critic, my dear friend, and I think she would have had a wonderful career in this business. She didn't really like being in front of the camera, in the spotlight, but she could have been a wonderful publicist or promoter. She loves it so much.
You were on the Lawrence Welk Show, the original productions, for about 12 years.
Yeah.
What are some of your special memories?
Well, one of my special memories was being able to bring my mom and dad down to the studio and dance in the audience for the first time. Then all their friends back home got to call them and tell them that they'd seen them. And I loved dancing with Lawrence. I learned so much and was the luckiest person in the world to be teamed with Jack Immel. So much of what I've learned on the production end of things is Jack's creativity and imagination. I've been so fortunate, and getting to sing with Sandy and Gail.
You started out singing on the Lawrence Welk Show. How did they discover that you could dance?
I think that was Jack Immel. I remember it was a Halloween show, and Bobby and Sissy were doing a number. I believe they were scarecrows. And they wanted a little girl to kind of skip through the set and drop her basket of goodies. Well, I did sort of a follow the yellow brick road step through, and Jack said, I think she can dance. And he must have talked to Lawrence, because they called me into the dressing room after that. And Lawrence said, you see, you didn't know you could do that, did you?
Well, you've been quite active with the Actors Conservatory Ensemble, something called Double Date, and Four Wonderful Women. What does all of that mean?
Actors Conservatory Ensemble is a producing theater company that some friends and I started in Los Angeles. We've an award-winning theater company. Uh-huh. And we started in 1990 out of a professional class that we took. And when our teachers passed away, we decided that we better put our money where our mouth was and start doing something. So we started a theater company, and we've been very successful, and we continue to this day. And Double Date was a doo-wop group that three of my friends and I started. We were in residence at Universal Studios for 11 years, from 1988 to 1999. And that started out, we saw they needed a group to open their Mel's Diner, their 50s area, up at the Universal Studios tour. And we went in and auditioned. We put a 4-song medley together. And they liked us, and they said, and what's your catalog of songs? And we just sort of looked at each other and said, you just heard it. So they liked us so much, they were willing to trust us. And we took a month, came up with about 60 songs, and 363 days a year, 5 shows a day. Mm. We were in residence at Universal.
And you're a Welk Show producer. How'd that get started?
That I owe to Larry Welk, who had faith in me to do something I knew nothing about. He was putting together a sales tape, and he asked me to pull some clips from the show because I was familiar with it. And midway through, he said, why don't you just go ahead and produce it? Well, fortunately, one of my partners in Actors Conservatory Ensemble, her father produced commercials, and his production manager, Wendell Wethington, took me under his wing and walked me through the steps and taught me all the stuff I know about video. So I've been blessed to be surrounded by wonderful, wonderful people.
And you've been producing a Christmas show at Escondido for a number of years.
That's been so much fun, because so often on the show, with an hour show, you only get to see a little bit of someone's talent. And when you can design a show around the people's talent, it lets you showcase them a little. And these are my pals. I love that. Please welcome the multi-talented musician, Bob Ralston.
Thank you, Mary Lou. So nice to be with you.
It's wonderful to have you here.
Thank you.
Who discovered your musical abilities first?
It was my mother. She was the original voice of Minnie Mouse when she went to work for Walt Disney. She was his 13th employee. And she not only was a good artist, but she had a nice ability to play the piano. She played popular music. And I guess when I was only two or three, she discovered the perfect pitch thing. I didn't even know the letters of the alphabet, but she could play a note on the piano, and with my back was turned, I could turn around, I could come and play that same note on the piano.
Amazing.
So she figured I had some sort of a ability there.
What did you want to be when you grew up?
A scientist. A chemist. Chemist in particular.
Did you really?
Yeah, I just love science. I still do. But in fact, I was going to enroll in college as a science major, but so many of my friends said, Bob, you play the piano so nice, maybe you should think about a career in music. And I said, no, I don't really want to, you know, be out there in the spotlight or anything. But I thought about it so seriously, I took a year off and didn't even go to college. I traveled for a year with an evangelistic team. And an amazing thing happened during those 12 months. People would come up after the meetings and they would say how my piano and organ playing touched their hearts. And I decided, well, maybe I did have a gift and I should use it. And so I decided to go into music.
There was a special lady in your life at the time, Mrs. Rood?
She was the pastor's wife at the First Baptist Church in Montebello. And when I was 15, after a Billy Graham evangelistic meeting at the church, and she'd been playing the Hammond organ just beautifully, and I thought that was the most beautiful thing I'd ever heard, you know, the big Leslie speaker with the Hammond. I went up to her and I said, Mrs. Rood, it was just incredibly beautiful, I have to tell you. She says, you know, I'd like to give you organ lessons. Would you like to take them? And I said, oh, thank you. But I said, we can barely afford to pay the $2 a week to the piano teacher. You know, we couldn't afford it. She said, the Lord's laid it on my heart to give you free lessons. Would you accept? And I said, would I? So she got me started on the organ. And as it turned out, I've made, I guess, more of a career as an organist than a pianist.
How wonderful.
So I'm always in her debt.
So you met her when you were 15. That was a big year for you.
It was.
You had a big birthday.
Yeah, that's right. You know what happened on my 15th birthday. Yeah, I met Lawrence Welk for the first time. He was a judge on a local show out in Los Angeles called Hollywood Opportunity. And I guess Bobby Burgess was on the same show.
He told me you beat him in that contest.
I beat him that day and won a new Dodge car. And our family hadn't had a car for several years, so it was just a blessing.
Oh, wonderful.
And I couldn't even drive it, but I sure started driving it when I turned 16.
Now, you also played brass instruments.
Yeah, with the Salvation Army, I started with the trombone and baritone horn when I was 10, and I played it for about 12 years through college, and even played the bass like your husband does with the Dixieland band on the Freddie Martin Orchestra for a couple of years on television. But, I thought I was maybe hot stuff in college. I was the lead trombonist at the ROTC marching band, but when Kenny Tremble loaned me his trombone at the Hollywood Palladium, and I tried to sit in with the Lawrence Welk show, I couldn't cut it. I mean, I was just terrible.
A new appreciation.
Yeah, I thought I better stick to the keyboards.
Now, you told me you made a tape for Top Tunes and New Talent. That was also a Lawrence Welk show.
It was. My mother was a fan of the show, and she said, son, you've got to make some demo recordings and send them into Lawrence Welk, and I did, and nothing happened. But I got a call from another orchestra leader called the Freddie Martin Orchestra, and they hired me as pianist, and later on I found out that they'd called up the Lawrence Welk office, talked to Kurt Ramsey, and said, well, we have a tape recording here of a young guy that sounds pretty decent, maybe you want to give him a try, so.
And the song, the piece you played on this particular show was Freddie Martin's theme song, wasn't it?
It was on the show we're seeing tonight. Yeah, Tonight We Love from the Tchaikovsky Concerto.
So how did you finally officially make it to the Lawrence Welk show?
Well, during those 3 years with the Freddie Martin Orchestra, I was doing recording sessions in Hollywood with a lot of different band leaders. Lawrence Welk was one of them. And he was there for his Moon River album. And I was doing a lot of big arpeggios and just all the way through. And he said, that sounds very nice. You want to be a guest on the show? And so I was a guest, and then I was a guest the next week, and after a few weeks, he finally said, let's make it permanent.
How did you start arranging? Because you did so many of your own arrangements.
Yeah, I did. Well, I studied orchestration and arranging in college, and did some work for Freddie Martin, And then it was just a sort of a natural thing to be one of the arrangers on the Welk show.
What part of your time on the show did you enjoy most?
Oh, playing for singers.
Really?
Yeah, my thing is accompanying. I've never wanted to be in the spotlight as a soloist, and I just feel I have my greatest gift to give when I'm playing for singers.
Well, anyone who's ever had you accompany them feels blessed.
Well, thank you. That's the nicest compliment, Mary Lou. I appreciate that.
You've always had a fascination with foreign languages and exotic animals, and how did all that come about?
Yeah, well, that's through my mother as well. We always had reptiles and other exotic pets, plus the usual cats and dogs and everything.
I remember a llama.
We had a pet llama, yeah, that was after I was married, and our kids always enjoyed him too. And actually, it was through my interest in languages that I met my wife. I was studying Dutch, and I heard these people were coming in from the Netherlands to visit Los Angeles. And one of them on the plane was a lady named Fietje Tangel. And she got off the plane, gave me a big kiss, total stranger. And I said, oh, I like these Dutch people. So I married her a year and a half later.
How many languages do you speak?
Oh, Mary Lou, I really don't speak anything except English. I've studied about 16 of them. I learn the grammar and a couple of thousand words and then move on, but...
Are you working on one now?
Russian.
How's that going?
Not too well. But I'll tell you, there's a lot more hope for my learning to speak Russian than there is on an Asian language. I studied Thai for about 6 months, and that's, like, hopeless with the tones, you know. Ma, 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 ma. It all sounds the same to us.
Amazing. You're an amazing man. You just were an opening act at the brand new Walt Disney Concert Hall.
Oh, that was fun. Yeah, they've got a huge classical pipe organ there, just gigantic. And I'm a theater pipe organist, so I was a little out of my element, but it was a show saluting Burt Bacharach and Hal David, that wonderful songwriting combination. So after I played the national anthem, I went into a couple of choruses of Do You Know the Way to San Jose, which seemed to work on that big organ. That was fun.
What was the greatest lesson you learned from Lawrence?
Oh, Mary Lou, I learned so much from this man. He was a marvelous man. Hard work, perseverance, you know. So many people give up just when they're just about to make it, you know. And I learned to keep trying. If I came to him with a suggestion he didn't like, the next week he didn't like my suggestion, I kept coming back. And eventually there would be something that he would like. So I think probably perseverance. Oh, and there's another thing I learned from him. He once said, my musical children, you'll make more money with comedy than with music.
He did?
Yeah. And, you know, some of the wonderful musicians on the show are great comedians, like Dick Dale, who's one of my favorites.
Oh,
he tells a joke
them fabulous
like
stories.
You wouldn't believe. But I take great delight when I'm entertaining an audience and I throw out a one-liner and they all laugh. I mean, that is funny. Can I tell you one right now?
Sure.
The other day I got home late from rehearsal, folks, and my wife was sitting there waiting patiently on the couch, and she said, Bob, I want to go out tonight to someplace really expensive. So I took her to a gas station.
What would you like to see your legacy be?
Probably my recordings. My latest album, called 33 Hymns We Love, has been getting such wonderful comments from listeners. They say the music that I play on the pipe organ there, those old hymns, has just touched their hearts, and that gives me a warm feeling, and I would like to do more recordings.
Well, we sure hope you do, and that you keep them coming for all of us.
Thank you, Mary Lou.
Thank you so much for being here with us.
Pleasure being with you.
Our special guest was on the very first national television broadcast of the Lawrence Welk Show, and I've had a crush on him ever since. We've all laughed at his hijinks and marveled at his musicianship. Please welcome Rocky Rockwell.
Oh, I love you, Mary Lou.
It's mutual. Does this show from 1960 bring back some memories for you?
Yes, it did. I watched it all. A lot of memories there. And especially with the bands and everything, and the individual, you know, musicians and everything.
And that was the largest band I've ever seen on the Welk Show.
Mm-hmm.
Eight strings, five trumpets.
Five trumpets.
Amazing. So, when you were a little boy in Missouri, mm-hmm. what did you want to be when you grew up?
I believe a horn player.
Really?
I believe so, yeah. Or as well as I can remember, I wanted to be a musician, because I started out so young.
How did you start with the trumpet?
I lay a lot of the blame, in grade school, the music teacher's name, you won't believe this, was Mrs. Sharp. And there was some piano players, the girls and violin players. And so Miss Sharp says, I'd like to start an orchestra here. And I loved, just as a kid, I loved that idea. But she said, we would like to have a brass or something. And she said, trumpet player. And she already knew, those that of us that might have been a little talented as far as having an ear, what we had call in, musical ear.
Sure.
And she said, so I took that idea home and presented it to my dad that I want to get in the orchestra there at McKinley High or grade school. And going to work one morning, my dad was an electrician, and he passed I'll call them hawk shop or pawn shop, early in the morning. And in the window was a silver trumpet. My dad looked at it and remembered what I said, bless his heart. And he goes in and he says, Mister, I only have a $5 bill in my pocket. Will you sell me that trumpet there for my son? He wants to play in a school band and everything. And the guy thought for a minute, and this is the story that my dad told over and over and over. And he took the horn out of the window and gave it to Dad, and he said, I wish him luck. And everything is a simple story, but that's how I acquired my first trumpet.
Did you love it right away?
Yes. Oh, I never stopped. My dad used to build, this back in the Depression and everything, he used to build what they call crystal sets.
Sure.
And he would put those on my ear. And when he took them off, I would raise a ruckus. Boy, you couldn't hear. I wanted that music, that young, that I believe it was an instigator or something that led me down that. Listen to music,
So how did you happen to meet Lawrence Welk?
Traveling, with some traveling bands and everything, and Pauline, my wife, and I, we settled in Grand Island, Nebraska, and I got a job on a radio station, KMMJ, and Lawrence Welk came through to town, and as he used to do promotional things, he would go to radio stations and, at that time, and make just look around and hand out tickets or pencils. He was a promoter. And so I was playing a broadcast. What do we call ourselves? Oh, golly. But it was just a polka band. And he came in and listened to the broadcast. And afterwards, he says, I'm looking for a trumpet player. Just like that. And said, would you be interested? And I couldn't commit or something like that. And he asked where I was from. I said, St. Joe, Missouri. He said, the Frog Hop Ballroom. He says, I'm going to be playing there. Would you come down and set in? So I rode this milk train down there. My dad picked me up, took me to the Frog Hop Ballroom that night. And I sat in with Lawrence. And halfway through it, he come back and he says, can you do anything else? And sing a song. And I'm no singer or nothing. But I sang Sunny Side of the Street. And Pauline's sisters were all in the audience, and a lot of the people there at St. Joe, they knew me. And the roof went off of the place, So I sat with Lawrence and Tom Archer, the ballroom operator back there in the Midwest, And he said, well, I think I can use you if you'd like to join my band. And he said, if you can play a polka, you can't be all bad. True story. True. That's how I met Lawrence Welk. And then later on, Dick Dale joined a few weeks before me in Omaha, Nebraska. That's how I came to be with Lawrence's band.
Now, when you were on tour with the band, I understand you had a great story about the Red Rocks Theater in Denver.
With Pete Fountain. We played there. Beautiful place. The acoustics was marvelous. And Pete, as you know, when he joined the band, he was bald. And Lawrence would keep kidding him about, you've got to get something growing up here, he would say. And finally, Pete gave in and got a toupee. So we started playing our concert, and the wind was blowing something fierce there.
So this was an outdoor concert?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Red Rocks Amphitheater. And Lawrence says, put your music away, boys. And he told the audience, they know everything by heart anyway. So we put it under our music stands, and he called Pete out to do his thing, and he started playing, and the toupee went like, and I stood up in the brass section with my trumpet and went bang, 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 to that effect, you know. And the people were laughing, and here come the little Lennons and everything, and they're chasing this black object along the along the floor. Pete's toupee, and brought it back to him. I can remember that so well too. It was the band stopped. You know, the people were roaring in that place.
And I'm sure Lawrence made the most of it.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. It was a showstopper. All right. Yeah, it was great.
Now, were you really Minnie the Mermaid on the show?
Mm-hmm. Larry Hooper's tune. Larry sang, oh, what a time I had with Minnie the Mermaid, blah, 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 blah. And I happened to be, believe this, in a mermaid costume, my legs all tight, stretched down in this tail, you know, down there. And I'm laying on the dock, and I have a gorgeous blonde wig. I don't know where Rose Weiss found that. But I had it laying there and blinking my eyes and listened to Larry sing. Well, the way the song ended, down at the bottom of the sea, and I'm supposed to fall off, or I did. I fell off. And Chuck, Crone, and all they had some mattresses down there for me to fall. And another guy had a bucket or half a bucket of water. And I was supposed to fall off, drop down on the mattresses, and then he was supposed to throw the water up in the air. Well, I fell. I did my part, you know. But there was no water, and it was a little dead air there. And finally somebody said, the water. And the water come up, and they said later, Rocky fell an awful long way, you know, before I hit.
Well, too, he was live back then.
Larry Hooper. Yeah, I was live. You bet.
Well, you were also married for 57 years.
Mm-hmm.
What's the secret?
What's the secret? I would say there's only one person that could be the secret, and that's Pauline Elizabeth Rockwell.
What a beautiful tribute.
My wife, yeah.
Rocky, we're so lucky to have you here.
Oh,
thanks for joining us.
No, I wouldn't have missed this for the world, Mary Lou.
Our special guest is a very special lady who graces any stage wherever she appears. Please welcome our beautiful champagne lady, Norma Zimmer.
Thank you, Mary Lou.
I'm so glad to have you here.
Thank you. It's a thrill to be here.
Last year, you gave every one of us a big scare when you had a heart attack. Right after you returned home from filming Precious Memories. What happened and how are you doing?
Oh, I'm just doing beautifully, thank you. I figure that it was a warning because I loved my cheese and butter and ice cream.
Me too.
And I've now discontinued those items in my diet, and I'm strictly, well, not strictly, but very much a vegetarian now. I don't eat a lot of red meat. I have lots of greenery. In fact, I make two of my meals salads now, with all types of wonderful vegetables. And it makes me feel so much better. I'm kind of glad that happened, because it wasn't a serious heart attack. And it made me wake up to what I'm doing to my body.
A blessing in disguise.
That's right.
Norma, who discovered your musical talent?
Oh, you know, first of all, my dad. My father was a wonderful violin teacher. And he gave me violin lessons every day of my life for 10 years. And when I realized my hands were too small to really master the instrument, he had me try singing. And he said, well, you have a pretty voice. So he started me on vocalises and so forth. And then in high school, Carl Pitzer, our choir director, gave me leads in the school operas and so forth, operettas, and asked me to join his church choir. And actually, it was through his church choir that I began to have solos. And he thought, too, that my voice was very outstanding. And we had concerts every year. Our choir would put on these wonderful concerts. And one year, our guest soloist was Lee Sweetland, who had the summer replacement for the Lawrence Tibbett radio show. And he said, I had a solo there too, and he said, Norma, if you ever come to Hollywood, you look me and my wife up, we might be able to help you. So, and then my girlfriend gave me a trip to Victoria, B.C. on a lovely Princess Line, and on the way back from Victoria, we had a song fest on deck. And a lovely couple sat next to me, and the gentleman said, hold it, everybody, this little girl has a pretty voice. And they kept saying more, more, more. I sang every song I knew. And that couple happened to be an Hollywood agents, and they said, if you ever get to Hollywood, look us up. So you see, I had so many wonderful opportunities.
So that's what brought you to California?
That's what brought me to Hollywood.
I know you had a difficult childhood. From reading your autobiography, there was alcoholism in your family and serious poverty.
Oh, yes.
How did you get through that without bitterness and anger?
You know, Mary Lou, I have seen other people who were bitter about something in their lives. It only hurt them. And I thought, my brother was bitter, too. And I thought, I'm not going to be bitter. I loved my parents. I understood that they were doing the best they knew how. And I thought, bitterness only hurts the one who's bitter. So I thought, get over it, you know, and just love them and accept them. But it was miserable when I grew up. I went hungry many times. And fortunately, we grew up in the Seattle area where there are a lot of natural foods. You go out digging for clams, crab, berries, and the blackberries just hang from the bushes up there.
You make it sound so wonderful.
Oh, well, it really is. It saved our lives, actually. And then I used to fish in the streams with a bent pin, and we'd catch trout, and Mom hated to clean them, but...
You also had a bit of a movie career.
Just a tiny one, a little bit part, but it was such fun. You know, I worked with Bing Crosby on his records and his radio show, and later some television, but he thought, too, that I had a pretty voice and said, why don't you do that little bit part in Mr. Music? So I did, got to sit at the edge of the stage with him and sing with him. It was a thrill.
There'll always be heaven yonder on.
Did you ever have a desire to pursue that?
No, I didn't. I was very happy with, I was a top soprano in a girls' quartet, and we did backup music for all the famous singing stars. And I was also thrilled to work with Nat King Cole and his original Nature Boy. I did the obbligato. And Nelson Riddle was very instrumental in some of the things that I did. He used my voice as a flute. And our son Mark has saved some of those old recordings. That's such fun to look back on those wonderful days. Of course, you know, I started way before television. I worked with Fanny Bryce and Bibi Snooks, Al Jolson, Eddie Cantor, Jack Benny, Lucille Ball, Burns and Allen, all these marvelous, fabulous artists. And I never had a camera with me. I didn't take one picture with all those fabulous stars.
Do you have a favorite star?
Probably my favorite was Bing Crosby. He was so natural, so charming. He always whistled, and he'd stroll along, pantomime with golf swings, you know. And we both came from Washington State, so we would have a contest to see who could remember the most Indian names. And Bing Crosby was the first fan letter that I got from him when I joined the Lawrence Welk Show.
Oh!
Isn't that fun?
How wonderful. Uh-huh. You have another blessing in your life, a wonderful husband, Randy.
Oh, I can't say enough wonderful things
about
him.
How long have you been married?
Well, we've celebrated 61 years, but I'd like to share with you that for our 60th anniversary, we've had no snow in Utah, so we drove to California and skied on Mammoth Mountain for our 60th
for your 60th anniversary? You skied on your 50th, too,
yes.
Didn't you?
Well, no, actually, our son Mark gave a beautiful garden party for our 50th, and we had 60 marvelous friends, some of our ski buddies there. It was beautiful. His home was gorgeous, and the garden was so lovely that your Linda real estate people, when he went to sell his home, said, "This is probably one of the most beautiful yards in Yorba Linda."
Oh, how beautiful. How did you become the champagne lady?
Well, actually, it was through my quartet work. We did backup for Lawrence on Yellow Bird and Calcutta,
really?
And so forth. And one time he did an album for Thanksgiving, and I had a little four-bar solo. And he said, "My, you have it pretty. That's very pretty. Come and do it on my Thanksgiving show." So the day I arrived, I think the Lord was watching after me because Joe Feeney got laryngitis that day. So there was room for a solo. And Lawrence said, "Do you have an arrangement we can use?" Fortunately, I had just worked with Paul Weston and Joe Stafford at the Hollywood Bowl, and he had made a lovely arrangement of "Smoke Gets in Your Eyes." And so I called Randy and said, "Honey, rush my arrangement of Smoke Gets in Your Eyes down to the studio." Now, he arrived maybe 10 minutes before airtime. And at that time, we were live.
Oh, boy.
Uh-huh. So we rehearsed it once, and I did it on the show. At that time, Lawrence had been without a girl singer for 2 years. And the switchboard lighted up, and people called in and said, "Why don't you make her your new singer?" So I was strictly an accident on the Lawrence Welk Show.
Oh, a blessed accident.
Well, I've been so privileged and so grateful to be a part of the show and to work with all of you. You're a family to me. I love you all so
much. We feel
much.
The same way about you.
And now the OETA people are like family.
And our audience.
Yes, oh, praise the Lord.
What did you learn from Lawrence?
to love the audience. You know, he really loved the audience. He always carried little gifts to give them. And he stayed until the last person left after our concerts. He really, truly wanted to give the people what they wanted to hear. He had many secretaries who kept records of the requests. And he taught me to just appreciate the audience, appreciate the fans. And he was very generous, too. You know, Randy and I had built a lovely mobile home park. And he would say, Norma, let me come and entertain your people. Out of the goodness of his heart, he would come out, maybe bring along Ken Delo and Bobby and Barbara and Arthur Duncan, and dance with our ladies. They were thrilled, you can imagine. But he was so wonderful. I miss him terribly.
I do too. Mm-hmm. We feel so blessed to have had time with you.
Thank you.
And also with you. You've been wonderful, and you are our family as well. So until next time, as Lawrence Welk always said, keep a song in your heart.